Overton. This time taken, Joan Root with the catch. And that is India all out for 78.
England closed the day on 120 without loss. A lead of 42 runs. Could not be in a more dominant position at the end of the first day. It is beyond their wildest dreams, beyond the wildest dreams of this crowd.
And a very good morning to all from Headingley. Cloudy skies, but dry, as we welcome you to the second day of that extraordinary opening yesterday to this third test match with India bundled out for 78 and England resuming on 124 no wickets. So lots to look ahead and look forward to if you're an England fan, and certainly see if India can come fighting back. And it's also a sad day, as we learnt today, that the former England captain Ted Dexter died yesterday after a recent illness. A tremendous character. Those of us who were lucky enough to come across Ted will know him precisely as that. But what a cricketer as well. He played 62 tests for England. He was a captain of 30 of them. He averaged the best part of 50 in test cricket. He would have been a brilliant T20 cricketer, I suspect. And he was one of those forward-thinking cricketers of that generation. So lots to remember about Ted, which we will be doing throughout the day, and particularly at lunchtime, but clearly we send our heartfelt condolences to his family and to his friends today. So we'll build up the cricket as well, obviously, today. Let's start with the weather, shall we? Because it's a bit chilly out there this morning. Sarah Jane Lucas is with us. Good morning, Sarah.
Good morning to you, Jonathan. Yes, chillier, isn't it today?
Yes.
There is indeed, and that's all down to the fact that we've had a cold front that's slipped its way south. So that has introduced that cooler and fresher air. And as you were saying, Jonathan, quite a bit of cloud overhead at Headingley at the moment. And really, that's the way it looks through today. It is going to be staying dry for day two today. Pretty cloudy conditions, but I think as we head through the afternoon, we'll just see a few glimpses of sunshine breaking through that cloud. Not lifting the temperature too much, though. Highs today only up to around about 16 degrees, and a bit of a breeze coming in from the north as well. As we head through the next few days, well, I think day three tomorrow will be not quite as chilly as it is today, and a little bit more sunshine, and really things are set to be staying dry on into the weekend as well. So no great change, but certainly not feeling particularly warm. Little bit of drizzle out to the east, but we are hopeful that things are going to be staying dry at Headingley today.
Lovely, Sarah. Thank you ever so much. That's great. Well, that's positive news, certainly. And dry for this test match. I wonder how long it's going to go on for, having been bundled along so quickly yesterday. 78 all out. Who would have thought that that was possibly going to happen? So, again, I mentioned the sad news overnight that Ted Dexter died aged 86. And before play today, the current England captain, Joe Root, paid tribute in conversation with Eleanor Oldroyd.
Joe, first of all, woke up this morning to the very sad news that Ted Dexter has died. What are your thoughts and memories of him?
Yeah, it's extremely sad. You know, Ted, obviously a brilliant servant to the English game, 30 test matches as captain, played a huge amount of test match cricket for England, former chief of selectors as well. So he gave so much to English cricket. I didn't really get much chance to spend much time with him, but he was kind enough to email me on a few occasions when I wasn't playing so well, trying to get me back into form, and was very helpful in that regard. So he'll be sorely missed, and hopefully we can put on a performance in his memory.
Because apart from being a captain, he was a very fine batsman as well, wasn't he?
Yeah, very stylish by all accounts. I didn't get the chance to see much of him play, but from what you hear, very stylish, very eye-catching, and you know, was an entertainer. So hopefully we can follow through on that after yesterday's performance.
What kind of things did he say to you? Do you remember from those emails?
He was trying to keep encouraging me to stay side on, not get my feet pointed down the wicket. Just technical things that I think when I played at my best, he'd seen and wanted me to follow through on. So yeah, it was very kind of him to go out his way to do that.
I'm sure he'd been very proud of the way you all played yesterday. Would you say that yesterday was more or less a perfect day of test cricket for you?
It was up there, yeah. I thought we were excellent yesterday. I thought we found a length early on that wicket. We exploited that, and we managed to build pressure for long periods of time. Everything that you expect and want in English conditions, we managed to follow through on. So a really pleasing performance with the ball. I thought we were ruthless at the back end of the innings, which was important coming off the back of Lords. And then that partnership was outstanding. You know, to get us off to that start, to really drive home that advantage that we'd created with the ball, with then to follow through with the bat was brilliant, and it puts us in a strong position today that now we've got an opportunity to be really ruthless, and we've got to take that forward now.
How nice was it to sit with your feet up in the pavilion knowing you weren't going to be going out to bat in the imminent future?
Brilliant, it was really nice, and you know, hopefully that can continue forward for the first session this morning as well.
Thanks so much, Joe.
There we are, Joe Root talking to Eleanor Oldroyd a few moments ago. Vic Marks is alongside me. Ted Dexter, it's difficult to say the name Ted without smiling, isn't it? He was just one of those immense characters.
Well, he was, and isn't it great to hear how, A, he took the time. He was always a great theorist.
Yes.
But he took the time to get in touch with the England captain and Joe Root, who is on a par with Ted as a batsman, let's face it. And also rather wonderful to hear Joe's response to the fact that he'd take, you know, his gratitude that he'd taken the time. And even though he's from a different era, I suspect Joe Root would have welcomed, respected and responded to the sort of advice that Ted had freely given.
Yes. Because he was a forward-thinking cricketer, typically that generation.
Well, he was a great theorist. I mean, you and I would have only just glimpsed him. I remember watching him in the early 60s on the telly.
Yeah, he's a bit older than me, Victor.
Yeah, and I also watched him live once play against Somerset when he came back and played in the John Player League.
Right.
And he was the most charismatic English cricketer, I reckon, of that era. Because when he scored runs, they were magnificent runs, and they were classical runs. And you didn't know whether he was aloof or shy. He was distant, a little bit different. I mean, you'll go through it all at lunchtime, but what a life he had. I mean, you know, you get very excited about flying here and there, but Ted flew to Australia in the 60s.
I know. He stopped 20-something times en
route.
That's
right. And he had sports cars, and he had model wife, and he had... he stood for Parliament against Jim Callaghan. All these things he packed into his life.
He rode around London with his leathers on a motorbike. He was chairman of selectors.
And I was talking to someone yesterday about a round of golf he had with Don Bradman with Wooders. John Woodcock has recently passed away acting as caddy. And Bradman and Dexter were basically playing off scratch. They were such good... Anyway, so he was an amazing figure and a wonderful batsman to watch. We've just been catching glimpses of his, you know, he kept getting the famous 70s, actually. And one of them was at Lord's in 1963 against the West Indies, where he took on the fast bowlers. But you'll touch on that later. But he was, you know, one of the great characters of English cricket and one of the great batsmen. And I suspect in that era, if you had a choice of, you know, who do I want to watch bat for an hour amongst England players, you'd have said, without really blinking, give me Dexter.
Yeah, yeah. It's funny, on the other hand, I remember there being a bit of a stink because he, in a one-day final, one of the first ones, I think, 63 or thereabouts, he decided that captain of Sussex, he would just simply put everyone on the boundary.
Exactly.
Which you could do in those days.
But that's just...
And that was his theory, and they won.
They won. Sussex won twice in the first three competitions of the first one-day knockout tournament. First time we had one-day cricket. And Ted was that sort of lateral thinker. Yes. Well, what's the logical thing to do here? And people would have been appalled. You can't put all nine men on the bench. Well, he said, actually, I can. And Sussex prevailed.
Yeah. No, well, we'll talk much more about Ted Dexter at lunchtime. I remember that you're probably at that press conference in India in 1993.
Where the stars weren't quite aligned.
Well, yes, because he was trying to explain the defeat in Calcutta in which India had chosen four spinners and England had chosen four fast bowlers.
That's right.
And it was obvious that they'd picked an absolutely appalling team. They got hammered. And inevitably, the press conference afterwards, Ted, being Ted, thought, well, yeah, what am I going to say? So he just came out and spun this line. Well, obviously the planets were properly aligned and that sort of stuff. You know, of course, people sucked in and basically thought he'd gone mad.
Well,
and he was just thinking, what else do you want me to say? You
know, well, also, sorts. I think it's a famous time. I mean, his time as chairman of selectors was not straightforward.
No.
And it wasn't a
particular... Malcolm Devon.
That's right. And we're looking into the, very importantly, through player stubble on chins. But actually...
A chaplain, I think the team chaplain was appointed.
That's right. But looking back at that tour of India very briefly, I always thought that actually he was just trying to help out and playing a canny game by saying something so preposterous that it kind of took the pressure away from Graham Gooch's captain.
Yes.
It was a selfless diversionary tactic.
Yes. And I remember also that bit about Root there saying about playing side on.
Yes.
I remember being at a net session in New Zealand, I think it was Wellington actually, where Graham Hick was batting in the nets.
Yes.
And Dexter was behind him, just out of the net, but behind him, saying, come on, get side on. That was obviously his thing, wasn't it? To be absolutely beautifully and perfectly a textbook side on.
Yes, I don't imagine he'd have enjoyed watching Dom Sibley bat very much at the last.
No, but he'd have loved T20 cricket, wouldn't he?
Yeah,
he'd have been one of the top earners in that.
Yeah, yeah, and he'd have loved the challenge of a new format too. As we talked about with the Gillette Cup coming in, he did stuff that none of the other county captains were prepared to do. I think he abandoned spinners for a while, but he put everyone, as I say, put everyone on the boundary and thought it through. And as I say, people got very upset that you can't play the game like this. Well, you didn't worry about that.
No. Well, it's a sad day, but you can't think about Ted Dexter and not smile, because if you've been lucky enough to spend some time in his company, he was just one of those very vivacious, very thoughtful, just very, very interesting men. It's sad that he's died, and we shall reflect on his life in more detail during the lunch break. But there's the dulcet tones of Jerusalem. And echoing around Headingley, which is rapidly filling up. See people pouring in down there at the far end. It'll be a full house again today. And what a day to follow yesterday. I mean, I think England supporters, and even the England team, I suspect, are probably still pinching themselves and probably opened the newspaper or whatever they did this morning, logged on to make sure that it actually happened.
Yeah.
Because it was such an extraordinary and unexpected turnaround. I think that's the key.
Yeah.
Vic. I mean, who would have thought that was going to happen?
Well, no one. I mean, it was the perfect day. It was. I mean, you don't get flawless days as an England cricketer, really. But actually, that's as close as you get. I mean, they took every chance.
Yeah.
The bowlers were right on the money. Not doing anything extravagant. I mean, I think the big pluses from yesterday, and we'll see whether they can consolidate, if you're in the England camp, is... I know this, you say I'm being parochial, but Overton made an impact for the first time.
Yeah.
And I was worried for him in that he bowled really well, putting that pressure on after with no reward, but he got his rewards in a hurry towards the end. But that's a step forward for him in terms of his own confidence. And the other one is the other player who's coming back is obviously Hamid, who started, he started a long time ago when Alistair Cook was still playing for England. And... impressed immensely. It's 4 years ago, I think, is it now, since he made his debut in India, and everyone got very excited and then had this amazing drop-off. So it's a big day today, especially after failing to score runs in his first comeback match. But to get 50 in the manner he did yesterday, now, if he can consolidate that this morning, well, his career suddenly takes another big leap forward. And he'll be in the England team for the foreseeable future. So they were the two major pluses, but the discipline in the field was terrific. And I wonder whether they're going to have to change their template looking ahead to the winter, assuming it all goes ahead, that we won't have a battery of very fast bowlers,
no.
But we might have an impressive little group of players who will operate in a manner similar to the Stroud side, where we lacked pace there, but there was a lot of discipline in that side. So that was encouraging. But anyway, they're out there.
They are indeed. And the
most astute England opening pair in living memory are about to get going.
They are. They've touched gloves and out they go, wearing black armbands. The umpires also in memory of Ted Dexter. And what a day it is for India too. They've had a few huddles this morning, certainly two, and there's a quick one then, but then Kohli was marching out like a man who really means business. I suspect he would not have slept very well last night, because he was pretty fired up when he won the toss for the first time ever in England. And I think he did the right thing. There'll be a few who say that India might have bowled first, but it didn't necessarily feel like a bowl first day to me. I think he did the right thing in batting first, but they just had a shocker, and the ball did a little bit. It didn't do so much for India, and they changed it at one stage, but even the replacement ball didn't move around very much either. So, it needs to be a much better day for them. They dropped a catch. The fielding was poor. It really was your original bad day at the office yesterday. Morning, Alistair Cook.
Good morning, Aggers. Good morning. Slightly surprised to see Ishant Sharma opening the bowling.
Well, so am I. I was going to let you say that. Because he set an awful tone yesterday, and it was surprisingly got the first over anyway, in my book. But that 9-ball over was absolutely the last thing that India would have wanted in reply. So he's having another go, and it's coming from our end, umpire Wharf, waiting for the Dickie Bird clock to tick around precisely to the top of the hour, which it now is. There's two slips and a fine gully. And Sharma is on his way, running down the slope, then bowls the left-handed Burns, and the first ball flicked away down a fine leg, and the fielder there does pretty well. He fumbles, but makes sure it doesn't go for four. It wasn't a great start again. The angle from round the wicket, just taking the ball onto Burns' leg stump, and another couple of yards finer. That would have been a boundary off the first ball.
You said he couldn't. You kind of think he's too good a bowler to bowl as badly as he did yesterday. You know, his record is outstanding, yeah. Ishan. And, yeah, for whatever reason, his rhythm wasn't there. You can almost see it on his first ball running down the hill. You know, it is flattened out a little bit, but it is still a hill. And he just looked tentative, didn't he, when he bowled? And same there. But you'd have thought a night of thinking about it, talking to the coaches, the experience he's got with his... how many games has he played? Almost, has he played 100 test matches?
Must be. Yes, he has, I think. He's, what, 33, 34? Andy Zoltzman's
he was going to tell us,
wasn't he? He's going to tell us. We remain on tenterhooks.
Good morning, everyone.
I've got a little button here, Andy, that I can press.
It's 104th test.
There you are. In goes Sharma over the wicket, and he bowls very wide outside Hameed's off stump. And I think if I were India, I think I might try and get stuck into Hameed a bit. I mean, bowl some short, hostile stuff. I'd like to see him. I'd set a short leg for him, but then I would for everybody by the sounds of it. But I would for him because he does like to get on that front foot. I think they've got to try and do something to take him out of his little bubble there.
Virat's just walked from first slip almost up to Hameed, and he's shouting at. I don't think he's shouting at Hameed, but he's very animated about something. Well, I can't quite work out what he is, but you're right. He means business, and I think
definitely
as an England side here today. It's about killing this first hour, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's about just taking the sting out of India. You know they're going to come very hard at them.
Sharma runs in, bowls outside the off stump. Hameed lets it go through again, getting that front foot well down the pitch. I'm not sure. He might have had a couple of bounces yesterday, but I think if I were India, they've got the firepower. I think I might just be trying to have a bit of a go at him.
It's definitely one and over at it. He's definitely a player as a... You definitely give him one and over. I don't think on this wicket with these overheads that you want to resort too much to that. But I think for a player like Hameed, he doesn't take on the hook shot. He's not going to hurt you with the hook shot. He looks to sway nicely. But I think just for his, you know, to put the batsman under pressure, I think, you know, I'm surprised India haven't gone there.
Sharma bowls and beats him as he pushes forward, hiding the bat there slightly behind the pad. But definitely playing at that. 121 for no wicket. I mean, sometimes with a newish batsman, let's face it, he is, back in again, you might see a team go, right, come on, let's really go short leg, leg slip, let's see what he's all about. And do you not advocate that in this case?
No, I don't think I would. I'll just say you give the one over, but that is the line you have to bowl at Headingley. You know, that bringing them forward, you know, India have still their four-man leg side, so they haven't got a gully or a four slip. I'd much rather... them challenging the outside edge there, but I just think by bowling that bouncer will stop Hameed getting as far forward as he does.
In goes Sharma, then bowls, there's a short ball, and he twitches slightly, sways out of the way, and that passes harmlessly by, around about neck height, and into pants gloves. He's chatting away already. Lots of shouts of encouragement from behind the stumps. My word, India have got to get 5-6 wickets this morning, you reckon, to get back into this.
Yeah, I mean, it's only ever happened once in my career that when we bowled Australia out for 98 and we were 150 for naught, and the talk was by Andrew Strauss, I can't remember who said the words, was it was the end of day one or beginning of day two, it was we just need to bat well once and the Ashes are ours. That was our thing on day two.
Then goes Sharma again, bowls outside the off stump, and he lets it go by. So the end of the over. I've got a question. I love name dropping in this business. I've had a text message, personal text message from someone you would never have heard of, Alistair. He was the lead singer of the Stranglers, which I suspect is well before your time. Hugh Cornwell, there's a question for you, Andy. Can you ask Andy if any test team has won a test by an innings without losing a wicket? He's an optimist. is Hugh. He loves his cricket, and he came on here as a view from the boundary and sang brilliantly quite a long time ago now. Trent Bridges, I hope you're well, Hugh. There's a roll of the eyes from Andy Zaltzman on that one.
I'm saying no.
I'm guessing no. I'll find out. Give me 5 minutes.
Yeah.
Just quickly on England, people have been asking for consistency from England's batting for a while. Well, they're getting it. 2 days in a row, England have scored 120 runs. 120 all out on the last day at Lord's. 120 for naught yesterday. So,
oh.
Progress.
Golden brown cookie?
Pardon?
Oh, no. Don't tell me.
I've actually have
always
heard,
the sun.
I have heard of them, and I do listen to them on my Magic FM time. So they definitely play occasionally. But I wouldn't know too many details. But I would recognise some of their songs.
It's a long slog with some of these youngsters. In comes Shammy round the wicket, bowl the bouncer, and Bob's under that one. It's taken by.
I'm going to get ganged up here because Zoltz seems to know what he's talking about.
Zoltz will be stranglers, man.
Not an avid fan, but I like their stuff a little before my time. But is it true, Agus? Maybe you can ask Hugh if they called themselves the Stranglers because they were massive fans of batsmen being caught down the leg side.
That's exactly it.
That cannot be true.
I can tell you, though, so I've just sort of sparked off this conversation, that I think it was on the first page of Hugh's autobiography. In comes Shammy, bowls, and that's pushed away down to gully. And there is no run. Nothing added this morning. He refers to Devon Malcolm because Hugh left the group. He left the Stranglers. Lead singer, I mean, the iconic voice and everything else. But
Devon didn't take his place, did he?
No, but he saw... No, he didn't. But he was watching cricket on the telly and Devon Malcolm hit a six. And Hugh watching thought, if Devon Malcolm can hit a six, I can leave the band. I can do it. I've got the guts to do it. I've just got to go and do it. And comes Shammy round the wicket, bowls, and Burns plays that down into the gully. It was Devon hitting a six. Goodness knows who it was against.
Well, I was just going to say, surely that.
Well, who can remind me who it was against? But that was what gave him, well, the oomph.
So if you're a big Stranglers,
courage to go out there and to leave the band.
If you're a big Stranglers fan. You need to hunt down that bowler who bowled the balls to allow Devon Malcolm to hit him for six.
Well, I think Hugh, hopefully, will tell us who it was.
To blame Devon, that bowler for it. You haven't got it, have you?
Well, Devon Malcolm hit seven sixes in his test career.
Oh, well, do you know who they're off? Can we list them? I suspect most of them are slow. But then why would he bowl a spinner at Devon Malcolm?
Top edge, hoik.
He hits a lot of sixes these days. Devon fancies his batting. He's a serious batsman now. Batted against us once as lunch watchman for Derbyshire. Came out he did. 3 minutes to go till lunch, last day of the game. I said, Devon, I just got a wicket. I said, what are you doing out here? I'm a lunch watchman. Then comes Shammy and bowls and Burns plays away in the odd side. I said, seriously? He said, yeah, I took guard, bowled him. We all walked off for lunch.
What? Who's the batsman that didn't want to face you? Sure, they're queuing up to face you.
I suspect John Morris. Thanks very much. But yeah, lunch watchman. Lost in one ball. That was it. Yeah, thank you, Alistair. You got that right early.
That's 1-0.
So we've got to track down these sixes. Intriguing.
He got one on debut against Australia. Test debut 1989.
When did the Stranglers? When did he leave?
Well, here's Shammy. Bowls played by Burns on a bit of a shuffle. Plays to mid wicket. No run again. It remains a 121 for no wicket. Was that one scored so far this morning off the first ball of the day?
Yeah, maybe we could help Zaltz because we could find out the year he left the Stranglers. Then that we can then go that way. He's obviously not listening.
No, I don't think he is. That's disappointing because we had the question answered as well. 121 for no wicket. If anyone knows, tms@bbc.co.uk. I think it's the first page of the book. Shammy under cloud moves in bowls and that's left alone by Burns and taken by the wicketkeeper. So there's one run added so far.
The fewest wickets a team has lost when winning a test is two.
Really?
So there haven't been any innings victories with no wickets down.
So was that a sort of a Bangladesh game or a Zimbabwe game or something like that?
Or a
rain-affected game?
First one was England against South Africa in 1924, 531 for two for England. South Africa quite weak in 24. England against New Zealand in 1958, again not a great team, against India in 74, South Africa against Bangladesh in 2003, in a match Alistair will no doubt tell us about. South Africa 637 for 2 at the Oval in 2012.
Hashim Amla.
Yeah. Thanks, Alt.
121 for no wicket. And in goes Sharma. He's there and he bowls short. And Hamid has a look at it and just ducks out the way.
First day was all right, wasn't it?
Yeah, I think I got 100. I think I batted through that day, didn't I? I think I got 100 in the first day and we were 270 for 3 or 4. And right. We thought, well, no, we've had a good day. And then I think we only got 350. So we lost our last few wickets. But we thought that was par. Probably a little bit below par, but in the game. And then Callis and Amla batted us.
Amla did play beautifully, didn't he? Oh. Well, that was an amazing innings.
Yeah, I mean, you kind of had like Callis just not looking like he's ever going to get out. I'm sure one of the other openers got a score as well. And yeah, that was
Sharma bowls, and Hamid wants a single. Yeah, very nicely played. Just pushing out with a dead bat really into the covers, and picking up his first run of the day. He goes to 60, 122 for no wicket.
Yeah, I mean, what a player he was. Him and Callis were.
Oh yeah.
I mean, it was one of those. I mean, when you're fielding. And you're in the field for a long time and it's not enjoyable, but there's that little bit of you just in awe of watching Callis and Amla bat that day, just thinking, that's how good you could be. That's what I always used to think. I watched a couple of those players, like, you know, I mean, if I knew I was half as good as that, because they just, you know, they were so controlled. It was such controlled batting and in gears too. I mean, Amla, I think only pushed up probably towards the end, he accelerated, but he just batted, he's so free-flowing, wasn't he? He's just very hard to stop scoring. And then Callis is so methodical and just so clinical with his batting.
Yeah. No, so it was quite a day.
It was 2 days up.
2 days, yes. Right, Hugh Cornwall's been on. Here we go. This will narrow it down a bit, Andy. And our pursuit to find the Malcolm six. In goes Sharma down the leg side, this one. Burns can't get anything on it. It's collected by Pant. So, right, left the band in the summer of 1990. But I can't remember who England were playing, so that's India, isn't it?
New Zealand and India.
New Zealand and India.
That summer.
Right, so that narrows it down a bit.
It wouldn't have been at Lords, would it? Because Devon wouldn't have been Lords where Gucci got all those runs at Lords.
Well, Devon might have played in that.
He did play in it, but he didn't bat. Oh. He did hit a six at the Oval that summer.
This is it.
There we go.
15 not out of 23 with a six and two fours.
Right, so there we go.
Against India. So you now need to look at the Indian bowlers.
Shammy bowls, and that's nicely played by Burns. On that front foot, playing bat and pad close together. Look, we'll get there. We'll find out who this is.
I just quickly, sorry, going back to the probably more serious stuff, isn't it? With Burns
more
and
serious,
Hamid.
Isn't it?
Yeah, no, I'm sorry. I'm sorry, Agus. Trying to in police work, whatever you want to call it. But just as a batsman here, you'd have thought India would bowl their best two bowls, wouldn't you? You'd have thought Bumrah and Shami, who are the ones who cause the most trouble. And it's actually, no, again, not. Disrespecting St. Sharma, but I think they'd be probably quite pleased when he was warming. Well, took the first over. I say watch him get a wicket now. But
in he goes, bowls on the leg stump, flicked away for four. Just dismissed, a little flick of the wrists, sending the ball away through square leg. Poor ball. Again, this is not what India want at all. Kohli's got his hands thrust about as deep as they can go into his pockets there at first slip. Not exactly casting a picture of happiness, if I'm honest.
Well, almost the body language already after 13 minutes has totally changed, wasn't it? That first over, you could hear him in the, hear the buzz in the stump mics in their ears, and then 10 minutes later, a couple of poor balls, and
there's a man out at deep square leg. That's it, India at the Oval on the Saturday. On the Saturday, it started off being so vague, and now suddenly it's all clicking together.
India's attack that match: Kapildev, Manoj Prabhakar, Atul Watson, Seema, who did play many tests, Narendra Hawani, the leg spinner, and Ravi Shastri.
Well, it's got to be one of those two, isn't it? 126 for no wicket. And Sharma pitching the ball up, playing up to mid-off to end that over. 126 for no wicket. Good start for England. They lead by 48. No alarms in the first 15 minutes of play. Burns, 57. And Hamid has 61. Just the start, but India desperate for a wicket. It's not the start at all. Kohli just looks quite dejected there, really. Hands behind his back now. Pant's offering some thought or other.
Hamid. This is a very elaborate way of taking guard. It's almost like somebody, the way he holds his bat, like a golfer lining up a putt with his putter. You know, they hold a putter vertically. Sort of line up to see what the elevation is.
Yeah, I think he makes three marks.
Yeah.
Just watching there, three marks. And he's very precise with his back foot, isn't it? Exactly where that back foot goes. He's very...
Yep, steps into it.
Yeah.
Sham is on his way, rushing in and bowls outside the off stump. And he looks at it, allows that one to go by outside that off stump, collected by punt moving down the leg side.
They've got a very short, straight mid-off. I don't know who it is fielding there, but again, it's a slightly strange field placing for Hamid. You're not a player who's going to particularly look to going to hurt you down the ground or even hit the ball that uppishly there, would you say?
No, but you're right. And the bowler would probably be able to stop it anyway, wouldn't he? Here comes Shammy, bowls. And that's again just outside that off stump. But if you see where Shammy is in the follow-through, he's more or less blocking that fielder off.
I'm just trying to work out why he's there to Hamid. And you want to encourage the drive. He's trying to encourage the drive, but he's not one of those players who tends to hit it uppishly there anyway, is he? But
no.
I don't watch it again. I'm always scared of saying something like that because you just feel as if the next ball. I'm glad Burns.
There's no such thing as a commentator's curse. I know people always have a go about that, but I promise you there isn't. 126 for no wicket. Shammy from the far end bustles in and bowls on the leg stump. That's nicely turned away by Hamid. Ball runs away quickly over the practice pitches for another four. And it's a poor delivery again. Leg stump. Hamid's very strong there. He's just one of those, he doesn't miss out. If you bowl something around that middle and leg stump, it's four. He knows where the fielders are. He just gives that little bit of a bottom-handed punch and works the ball precisely where he wants it to go. Nice follow through. Good shot. And now there's a deep square leg for him too, and that's really there for the poor ball.
Yeah, so you've got overhead conditions are cloudy, and India have got only two slips.
Yeah.
Again, it doesn't make too much sense.
Shammy again, bowls. It's a little shorter, steered into the offside by Hamid, who played a couple of lovely late glances through the offside towards the end of the day yesterday.
You know, it's so hard, and it shows how the runs you score in the first innings affect the game. Because if India got a score, and this is day three, you know, you can be very simple as a captain, can't you? It's really being patient and just putting the balls in the right area. And actually, it requires exactly the same thing. But as a captain, you feel as if you've got to do something, chase it a little bit, trying to make an impact, and it just plays into the opposition's hand. It's like the slow death from India is going to happen over the next couple of days, you feel.
Shammy again, bowls outside the off stump. That keeps a little bit low. Pump goes down on one knee there to gather it. So Hamid again plays no stroke. Yes, yeah, so a very short mid-off, short mid-wicket as well. But there's no sign really of much movement today. At least not at the moment. England lead by 52. Dramatic day yesterday. Sense the anticipation here, this full house are buzzing. India desperate for wickets, and Shammy bowls a very high bouncer, which Hamid can easily get underneath. He does so, and ball goes flying through to Rishabh Pant. 130 for no wicket then, so the lead 52. Burns has 57 and Hamid has 65. Cooking, some more thoughts from you. And then, for the first time today, it's going to be Isha Gua. We are colour-coordinated today, in part.
Lovely start from England this morning. Just carried on where they left off. Yes, they really controlled, calm batting. It obviously hasn't happened too much over the last year or so. It's gives England such a platform, such a great platform. And the opening partnership like this, 130 and still growing. Zishan Sharma runs in. Sorry, Andy, you wanted to do it.
It's a full-length ball on off stump. Burns comes neatly forward, defends into the offside. Not the most smooth of changeovers. The baton slightly dropped.
Good morning. Good morning.
We're there.
I had my mic pointed upwards.
towards the sky. Oh dear. You took your opportunity well, Andy. I felt
he wants another one. He's got it ready again.
He's good to go. Might just nip in. Ishant Sharma then. So tall in stature, shirt hanging out of his trousers, he pushes away towards a left-handed Burns, two slips in position, bowls around the wicket, allows it to pass. Gloomy conditions here in Headingley, slightly cooler as well this morning on ground. Alistair, we were just pitch side in the... definitely a temperature drop from yesterday.
But yesterday afternoon was quite warm, wasn't it?
It's gorgeous.
As India would have wanted these conditions to bowl in, maybe a few degrees warmer than they would have liked. But yeah, I'm surprised Ishant Sharma's opened the bowling. I thought, Bumrah bowled beautifully yesterday. It was the pick of the bowlers by quite a way. And Shami, though he hasn't quite got it right today, has bowled well on this tour. And I thought, just keep it simple as a captain. Your best two bowls, start the day. Try and set that tone. I know it's a cliched stuff. And Ishant wasn't on form.
He bowls now. Burns tucks it to mid-wicket off the front foot. No run.
Yeah, he struggled with rhythm and he's throwing the new ball, or the first ball sort of the day.
I just wonder if Virat Kohli's backing his sort of experienced player who's really good at bowling round the wickets of the left-handers, and if he gets it right, he is a serious threat in these conditions, but he just hasn't quite... He hasn't quite found it, has he?
I think you're right. I think that's what he's gone for. But Bumrah bowls nicely to the left hand as well. Yeah. Unless they're saving Bumrah, thinking get a wicket and then target Milan and Root. I don't know, but he is out there, isn't he? We haven't missed
Bumrah.
Yeah,
he's at mid on. Yeah, wide-ish mid on. Jumper on as Sharma bowls. Burns this time clips it past mid wicket to his left, out to the deep mid wicket boundary. Deep square is chasing it down and it stopped. That is Siraj. Diving to his right to stop the ball from going into that advertising sponge, and they come back for three. Burns then to 60, 133 for no loss. England lead of 55.
Yeah, Ishant hasn't got that shape away from the left-hander. Like when I always found him hard to line up because he did it from his wide angle and managed to get the ability, very much like Stuart Broad to David Warner, the ability to take the ball away from the left-hander. But all that angle today seems to be just pushing into Burns' pad. Burns has played very nicely straight and clipped him a couple of times to the leg side, so there's none of that real away shape at all.
As Hameed is on strike, back and across and defending. Back down the pitch. It's wide over the ball, back right next to his pad. Waits on it. Plays it with that angled bat onto the pitch. I was listening to Ewan Agers talk about some previous moments in Test cricket, and Hashim Amla and Jacques Callis batting together. Myself and Agus had a chat the other day about how you search for those memories, and he very much over the course of an over gradually got there.
Well, I think that the opening partnership yesterday,
as Ishant is past the stumps to Hameed, who's defending again quite late, pops up and he guides it to point. No
one? Yeah, was it the highest one since actually Hameed and my ones at Rajkot in 2016? And Vaughan had the stat right at the end of the day, and we're doing it on the TV highlights. And I didn't know what the stat was, and he said, "Oh, hold on." And then they got an extra run, and he said it extra. He said, "Do you remember that?" And I just went, "No," because I couldn't actually remember we put on 180 at Rajkot. It's only then after you put your microphones down, you've done it, that game starts to come back to you a little bit. But at that time, and then you start, as you say, you piece together, and then a few instances in that game come back, and I am struggling to remember that one. I think, was that the first of the series?
It's that slow recollection, isn't it? And Agus was saying that sometimes it's a moment of not necessarily thinking about who scored what, but it's just remembering what someone wore that day, and I sometimes find that actually. I have to think about what maybe I was wearing that day to remind myself of what was going on out in the middle. Shami is in to Burns, who's looking to play at leg side. Strikes him on the thigh pad and it trickles away to the leg side. 133 for no loss in England at the end of that last over. Burns on 60, Hameed on 65. having to search deep into your hippocampus in your brain where you store all those memories.
What's that word?
The hippocampus. It's where memories are formed, I think.
I did not
all know that processing and the neurons firing and all that.
You do biology at school?
Back in the day, a long time ago.
Good knowledge, very long time.
And they're stored away somewhere and you just need kind of reminders of how to grab them back again. There's Shammy, has passed the stumps to Burns, clipping it to mid-wicket, no run. Yellow towel poking out the back of his trousers as he casually walks back.
It could be a long day for India, this, couldn't
yeah.
It could be a really long day. When Test cricket comes really tough, you know, you can't win it in 3 hours, but you can suddenly lose it, and then you kind of have the rest of the game where you almost feel now, coming to day two, that England, you know, I don't know what Crick Viz would say.
Shammy bowls, Burns defends to the leg side.
Well, Crick Viz would say the actual stats at this moment in time of India winning this game, but you'd given them 2%, 1%.
Yeah.
You know, they'd had to get 5 wickets early. You know, you'd have to say they'd have to get back in this game, but you can't really, don't know how many times you concede a game with, you know, a lead of 150 or 200 and then come back and win the game. But England got this opportunity on a pretty good wicket now to really push that lead on. You know, you're looking at now, you bat all day today and England's lead will be 300.
Andy's got it.
Currently, Winviz gives India a 4% chance of victory, which seems a little generous.
Burns crouches back and across.
I mean, I think they're hunting defends. For, they're hunting, aren't they, for the, if India suddenly get 3 wickets. But, you know, it's all, as sometimes the stars aligned, England's batting now, you know, with Craig Overton coming in at probably 9, Ollie Robinson 10, that's real, real depth in their batting, isn't it? You just, you know, the slow death.
Cricket's a funny game,
oh,
hey?
It's a mad game.
When you think of,
well, you just think for England, actually, they got a little bit of luck, probably like India did in the first test match with the toss, actually, that, you know, that 3 hours, for England to bowl first in those 3 hours, where it probably was a bat-first wicket.
Shall we round the wicket to Burns, covering his off stump to the offside, no run?
It's probably a bat-first wicket, but it was going to be tricky for those 2 hours. It gives England a free shot as a bowling side. You know, they haven't got the pressure of winning the toss and bowling, and that instantly puts a pressure on the bowling, on your bowling attack, that we've got to take early wickets, otherwise, you know, if we don't, the opposition get 250, 260 on day one for 4 or 3, and then you're kind of behind the game already. I think it's going to be a quite dry wicket, so I do think it will spin days 4 and 5 if we get there. So they kind of have a free shot at India. Under India, know they've got to get through that first 3 hours. They didn't, and now kind of the game's done. All on a toss of a coin.
Burns defends, back down the pitch.
All of a toss of a coin, sorry. And Joe Root, he didn't know what to do, did he? And if it had gone the other way, you know, you just don't know, do you? So,
yeah.
But what you do have to do is make, obviously, the most of the conditions, and England were superb yesterday with the ball.
Yeah, they really were. Led by Jimmy Anderson for those 3 early wickets. 133 for no loss then, England. And a lead of 55. Burns on 60. Hamid on 65. What a partnership. It's been 22nd opening partnership, I believe, Andy, since Andrew Strauss retired.
Yes, yeah, 22 different pairs of openers.
Think it'll stick, Alistair?
Well, you'd hope so. you hope they can build a partnership and score runs for England and start laying more
Mead
consistent
drives, finds its way to extra cover, no run.
Consistent platforms for the middle order to build on.
I've just been informed by Jonathan Agnew. It's Rory Burns' birthday today.
Oh, happy birthday.
Happy birthday, Rory.
How old is he? It's not magic 30, is he? Or 31? 31? He's going to be 29 now, isn't he? Giving him a couple extra years. As your computer works over.
31.
31. Oh, he scored a century earlier on this summer. Can he go on to 3 figures again here at Headingley? 2 slips in the gully in position then for Ishant Sharma, bowling over the wicket to the right-handed Hamid, who beats the edge as it goes through to Rishabh Pant. He tossed the ball up in the air. We thought maybe there was a nick, And now Virat Kohli, hands in the air and rocking his head back because it was mightily close to the outside edge. Just had a little flirt at it. It's the first time he has been a little bit loose outside the off stump.
Yeah, it's a fist ump ball, which he could have, you know, he leaves very well. He could have left that one. I thought I heard a little noise in my headphones, and Hamid looked around, didn't he? And that's normally a clue that you do hit it as a batsman, but obviously not.
Still in his crease. Hamid back and across, this time defending, catches the outer pile of the bat. Gully diving to his right to stop it from going through down to the third man fence as Hamid comes through for one. Moves to 66, 134 for no loss. England.
Yeah, it's been a couple of times in his innings where Hamid has out of nowhere played that line. You know, he's such a good lever, such a great skill as an opening batsman to be able to leave the ball, and he has that ability of judgment of line, but just occasionally he has got it wrong in this innings. But you know, he got dropped at 46, I think, or maybe going to his 50. But you know, he has looked very controlled and very, he owns that off stump, that fourth stump line very nicely.
Deep point out for Burns. Ishaan Sharma's going to try over the wicket now to him. That angle across, two slips in position. Ball's full. Burns clips out to deep backward square, who's hustling in to collect the ball. Come through for one. Moves to 61 now. Rory Burns, and 135 for no loss. A lead of 57 for England. You couldn't have dreamed of being in this position, especially after the way they've been playing. Knives were out, and it's been such a change in the way this England team have played in this test match. It'd be interesting to know, Andy, what the quick viz would be for a draw if... Oh, it's 3%. 3% for if Dom Sibley was playing or not.
they don't put that on their app.
Here comes Sharma, past the stumps. Hamid, this time forward and defending straight down. Full face of the bat. He's got a leg slip in position, has Virat Kohli, and a deep backward square. So perhaps a couple of shorter ones are right for him to tuck around the corner, maybe. So Asa Cook has stepped down, and in comes Michael Vaughan. His beige jacket on. I've been subconsciously coordinating again today. Jonathan Agnew with a dark brown jacket this morning as Sharma is in. Hamid with an angle bat again, getting down and over the ball on the front foot to defend. End of the over, 135 for no loss. 49 overs have been bowled in this innings. A lead of 57 for England. Burns 61, Hamid 66. I mentioned subconscious coordinating in terms of the wardrobe, and Jonathan Agnew with a dark brown jacket this morning. I have this sort of dark brown tank top, and yourself with a beige, Ebony with a beige trousers.
You would
Alistair
think that
with the brown belt.
You would think that we have a WhatsApp group that states what we need to be wearing. What are India doing? Is the question. I mean, Jasprit Bumrah, how he's not bowled at the start on day two when you desperately need wickets as a team is beyond me.
Shami bustles in, Burns whips the ball to mid-wicket, no run.
Well, yesterday Bumrah, 12 overs, none for 19. Four of those runs came from a drop catch. All the three other Indian teamers all went for more than three and over.
Well, there's many ways to captain, and there's lots of different tactics, but fundamentally it's quite simple. When you desperately need wickets, you start the next day knowing that you have to win that first out with your best bowler.
Yep.
And so far we've not seen him.
He's there at mid-on as Shami is in again. Burns this time tucking it away to mid-wicket, sets off for a single but realises it's too close to that mid-wicket fielder who's steaming in, no run.
Yeah, that's right. We have seen him, but he's not bowling. We can see he's at mid-on. But I go back to yesterday. I mean, India, for whatever reason, they just arrived and played poorly with the bat. But you then looked at them in the field and they just didn't look with it. They started with Ishant
Ragged.
Sharma. I don't know why they started with Ishant Sharma. They started with Ishant Sharma. I thought Ishant Sharma was by far the worst of the bowlers yesterday. They start with him today.
It feels like a loyalty thing from Virat Kohli.
I don't get that. I mean, surely the loyalty is with Jasprit Bumrah, yeah. Your best bowler.
Yeah.
I've just seen something on social media which has amused me. And it's a picture of Virat at the toss. And it says...
This is just a little break in play as Burns is asking someone to move behind this sight screen. Won the toss and decided to bat and bowl on the same day.
it's amused me.
There's Shami, who's passed the stumps to Burns, who's defending solidly back down to mid-off, no run. Well, it doesn't happen very often. You'd have to say that it was their worst day of the year for India. And for England, it... their best day of the year.
Best day for many years.
Yeah.
In terms of a full day's cricket, I mean, clearly it can't go any better. I guess India, we're slightly concerned. They were bowled out for 36.
Mm.
At Adelaide, not too short while ago. It was just before Christmas. So this batting lineup of India is strong on paper, but it's also very vulnerable.
Burns edges, but doesn't go to hand as Siraj runs around from point to stop the ball.
He's coming on Bumrah. Same at mid-on. Yeah. He's
doing some stretching, yeah.
Touching his toes.
He's got a long sleeve shirt and a short sleeve jumper on, I think. Quite cool conditions here in Headingley today.
Would you say cold or cool? Nice, isn't it?
Yeah.
Pleasant. I thought it was a bit hot yesterday.
It was.
A bit humid.
Gorgeous.
Maybe that's why it swung so much in the morning. Mm. Humidity.
Shami moves in. Burns tucks the ball to mid-wicket. No run. It's... You would say that... It's very rare for India to have a really bad day just with the current team that they have.
Well, they shouldn't. With that amount of ability and... You know, experience, you can have bad days, but to have... I mean, yesterday was an awful day.
Yeah, it was.
It was probably awful with a cherry on the top. It was a terrible day for India. So you wouldn't expect them to have that kind of day. You expect them to have an iffy day, a bad day.
Shami bowls and out! Inside edge, onto the stumps for Rory Burns. Looking to play the ball. I think it was a little bit loose. Wasn't a full defensive shot. And India have their breakthrough. They gather together now in the middle, pitch size. And that's their opening, 135 for one. And it won't be a three figures for Rory Burns. Hits the top of off, Mohammad Shami bowling round the wicket. As he trudges off the field now.
Yeah, it is a little bit loose from Rory Burns, but... Just an element of seam movement back through the gate. And you've heard it so many times at Headingley, you just have to live there. You've got to live that. Even when the ball's not doing as much, you've just got to live full of length and then you set the fields accordingly. If it's not swinging as much, you just set more of a defensive field, and when it starts to swing, you set obviously more of a cordon. But there will always be the odd ball that does something from that full of length if you're consistent.
Well, it's been a little while since we've seen David Milan in test colours. Burns out for 61 then, a lead of 57. Here he comes. He sprinted out onto the field. He's played 15 test matches, averages 27. A century, and he scored in Perth. And his last test match against India in Birmingham in 2018. He's made the move up to Yorkshire to play here. First class match earlier this season, he scored 199, scored a double century last season here at Headingley, but he hasn't played a lot for red ball cricket. David Milan, here he is now.
What was his last red ball game, Andy? Seemed to be a May time, maybe.
Just look at the replay, it was a good ball. Round the wicket, angled in, and delight for the Indian captain Virat Kohli. So David Milan at the non-striker's end as Hamid just remarks his guard. And here we go. Jasprit Bumrah.
Finally.
Bowling from the Kirkstall Lane end. Replacing Ishant Sharma. Two slips and a gully in position. He's got deep backwards square and fine leg on the boundary. Big space on the offside. Mid-off, almost in that extra cover position as he's in now. Shuffling forwards. Here comes Jasprit Bumrah to Hamid, who's on the back foot defending. No run.
Milan's last Red Bull game, in fact his only Red Bull game in the last 12 months, was at the start of June against Sussex here at Headingley. He made 199. His previous Red Bull game, also at Headingley against Derbyshire, made 219.
I mean, good nick then.
Good nick, but spread over 54 weeks.
Not as good as your last game.
We'll be drawing from those memories. He just rehearses a couple of drives at the non-striker's end as Bumrah is in again to Hamid, who's defending solidly again.
Yeah, his forward defence has been excellent. I think it's right under his eye line, letting the ball come to him, a nice balance. And what I've liked about, I mean, on that occasion he didn't, but on the most times he's played, he's looked to grab a single as well, which is exactly the way you should be playing. You should be trying to steal singles, get down the other end. It just gives you a breather as a batter. Don't want to be facing a full over of someone like Jasprit Bumrah. You can sneak down the other end.
Bumrah moves in. Hamid leaves outside the off stump. It's a good lunge forwards and then rotates his hips. Back comes behind him, allows it to go through, watches it all the way. He'll be desperate, won't he? I see Hamid having got himself in, having done all the hard work to make it a big one, as he delicately places his bat down. Gives it a tap, now still in his crease, back and across. Again leaves the ball, it's left it on length. India were interested, it jagged back significantly.
It's amazing, isn't it, cricket? It did nothing yesterday afternoon, it did nothing for the first 30 odd minutes this morning. Suddenly a wicket goes, and that last ball then just moved off the scene. We've not seen any of that. We didn't see any of this from Ishant Sharma. That's a quite large seam movement back into Haseeb Hamid. He leaves it nicely, bounced over the top of the stumps.
Bumrah walks forwards, now into his stutter. Bowls and Sam covers the ball outside the off stump. Haseeb Hamid, high left elbow.
Something about a forward defensive. I don't think we celebrate it enough. Andy, you like it, don't you? Andy, I can see him looking.
Love a forward defensive.
It's just lovely, isn't it? It's just there's something very calming when you see a batter that can just play a nice forward defence.
Kane Williamson.
Yeah, it sends a message that there's a chance you might be able to survive for a while.
Bumrah past the stumps as Hamid works it out to deep square. The wicket chases after the ball to collect it. He comes through for one. Just slightly straighter on that occasion from Bumrah. At the end of the over, it's 136 for one, a lead of 58. Milan then on naught. He's out in the middle with Haseeb Hamid, who's on 67. A few words from you, Michael, and then it will be Dan Norcross.
Well, I think Andy's going to give us some stats on forward defence.
Not on forward defence, just on Rory Burns' final figure, 61 from 153 balls, so the 6 and 6 fours. His 13th 50-plus score in tests, and his third of this summer, all in first innings, and he also had a 49 in first innings in the last test. The partnership, 135 in exactly 50 overs, England's highest since Cook and Hamid added 180 in Rajkot in 2016. Their highest at home since Cook and Lythe on this ground made 177 for the first wicket against New Zealand. And the partnership in exactly 50 overs, it's only the second time in the last 10 years in tests in England that the first wicket has taken 50 overs or more.
I saw another further stat actually on that, which was the last three England opening partnerships, the last 45 overs, half a day or more. Well, this one, Burns and Hamid, and then two with Cook and Hamid. There appears to be a seam running through these lengthy opening partnerships.
Yes, there were two in India. One, the partnership in Rajkot, and they added.
It was a very slow one, wasn't there?
And then there was one when England were batting for a draw, and they put on 75 in over 50 overs.
Two slips are in, short mid wicket, mid on, a deep backward square, and a long leg, as well as a sort of straight short mid off. An extra cover, a point to Hamid, as Shami is in to the right hander, who drives but can't beat backward point.
See, Dan, that's
no run.
I think what needs to happen in cricket for us to celebrate the forward defence more so,
yes,
is on the scorecard, it reads the number and it'll say the amount of fours.
Yes.
Six. Mm. Six is three.
Yeah.
There should be an FD. forward defence. How many forward defences that player played?
It's also the forward defence that comes back up the wicket to the bowler is a thing of sublime beauty, isn't it?
Yes, it's just glorious.
Here comes Shami, bustling in.
Yes,
Hamid
that one.
Plays the forward defence. Too short. Yes. Extra cover or straight middle.
Could this be the next innovation in short form cricket? That if you play the perfect four defensive, you get eight runs for the team. So you've got to make that choice. Do you go for six or do you go for eight?
But it has to be played and the ball has to... There should be a big circle.
Yeah.
And if you've played and it goes into that circle, you get eight. Or if it goes outside of it, you get none.
Like cricket max.
Yeah.
But yeah, this would be a way of making white ball cricketers prepared for test cricket.
Yeah.
This is a brilliant idea.
Revolutionary idea. That's
Shami in again, and another immaculate forward defence. This time slightly to the onside, might not quite fit in that circle. Where are you? How far are you imagining the circle to be? The radius of it, really.
Who's that on the drive? Is that Pujara on the drive there?
Just
like short mid off.
Short mid off.
I think if the ball lands in a 2 metre circle where he is, maybe a little bit close, because I want real soft hands.
Right, so it mustn't go beyond it.
No.
Sort of land right in it. I'm liking this. Here's Shami. And Hamid plays another forward defence, and it sort of rolls towards that, towards Pujara, but it doesn't quite reach him. A little bit too close.
I think it could have been close to an eight, that.
Yeah?
He seems to have all the time. He's got a nice little trigger movement. I see that gets him in a wider base. He almost sets himself for that forward defence just to make sure that he's transferring his weight over that front pad.
I'm thinking about this eight though now, but presumably the fielder's not allowed to come in and field the ball until it's rested in that spot.
It's got to stop.
Shami in, driven into the ground. Pujara takes the ball above his head in that short mid-off position. Sort of position that you used to use things like that, didn't you, to get in the eye line of Matthew Hayden, Justin Langer?
Well, you're basically saying to the batter, go on, try and drive one down the ground. There's not a great deal of movement off the pitch through the air, so you're almost trying to make Haseeb think that he might be able to just punch one down the ground off length. Might miscue it, might get him through the gate.
Shami. Oh, it goes again. Forward defence from Hamid. Just a perfect over from Hamid. He's blocked out a maiden. England 136-41 at the end of the over, having lost Rory Burns with a score on 135, which is, of course, what I believe Ben Stokes scored in the last Test match here a couple of years ago. Mm. There's all these little echoes coming. Like yesterday when India lost four wickets on 67. It's curious. Now, Dawid Malan. This is an intriguing moment in Dawid Malan's career. Brought back into the England side, one of six men 30 years old or over out of England's top seven. What do you think? Isn't that right? I think that's right, isn't it?
And they began the summer with one of their youngest ever batting lineups.
And Lawrence and Pope and
Crawley. Now got to the dad's army, come on, Sibley, the veterans.
But it actually sort of feels... That's sort of the composition of a test team. Feels like it ought to be.
Yeah, I agree.
Batters in their late 20s, early 30s, and bowlers in their mid-20s, you know, Anderson being the anomaly here. Sort of feels like the right composition of a side.
Well, there's three slips in a gully. For Bumrah to Dawid Malan.
Here is Bumrah. Malan's first ball. And drives it. It's a full length, almost Yorker length delivery. Drives into the offside. That'll make it feel a bit better. Bit of bat on ball. And there's no run. left-hander is out, a left-hander's come in. The whole balance and composition of England's batting looks very different, but part of it looks different because of the match situation. Having bowled India out for 78, then suddenly Root, Bairstow, Butler, Moeen looks very strong, doesn't it? As Bumrah runs in, hops in, skips in, and Malan defends late. Not a classic forward defence. Stays at the crease, not that big stride of Hamid.
No, he's not getting an eight.
Okay. So you've got to actually play it right, so you've got to get artistic impression points, because you could sort of dab it crabbily. Well,
if we're going to do it properly, you know, it's like a judging panel on the side of the pitch with scorecards.
Oh, well, I like
that idea. For the actual element of technique. You need the technique first, and then you can get the eight if it goes into the circle. But the technique has to come first.
And artistic impression as well?
Yes.
Extra marks for elegance?
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
Jeffrey would have scored a lot of runs, wouldn't he? This way. Well, he scored quite a lot anyway. Bumrah in outside the off stump. Left alone by Malan. Through to the keeper punt, and there's their run.
Yeah, what they'll try and do to Malan is that kind of thigh pad height where the ball's travelling past the stumps at thigh pad height. He had a few problems in his last stint in Test match cricket around that height, kind of just on and around fourth stump. It's like dabbing at the ball. You know, where he likes it is nice and full. He's got a beautiful cover drive, straight drive. It's that in-between length that India will try and bowl to him.
What's his record against India, Andy? As Bumrah is into Malan. Malan covers up in defence again. Staying on the back foot, pushes it just back with a square on the offside. It's picked up. Gully region, there's no run. Run's just drying up here at the moment as England have just lost their first wicket, that of Rory Burns. Bowled a beauty, but there was a gap between back.
Would be on your judging panel.
Well, I don't like to say it, but Jeffrey probably.
Jeffrey would be on there. And they'd have thrones, wouldn't they, the panel, just by the pitch. Sitting there studying forward defence all day.
I like Pajara's forward defence. Yeah. I think he's lost it a bit at the minute.
Yeah,
well, he has a minute, but you know, I think he knows what it's supposed to look like. Malan drives elegantly through the offside. Didn't time it perfectly, but it's running away towards the boundary and we'll get there. Through the covers. In front of square, well in front of square and along the ground. It didn't make the most beautiful sound, but he got a bit of a stride in, hit it onto those fast practice pitches and away it ran for four. 140 for one. Malan is on his way.
Malan's record against India, just played one test against them, his last test before being omitted from the England side in 2018. LBW Shami for eight in the first innings and caught by Rahane off Sharma for 20 in the second.
That little bit of slip.
Yeah, that was a nice drive, that wasn't it, to get off the mark.
What's nice?
Came off the toe end of the bat, but he just raced across the square here at Henley. Goes right across the ground.
Bumrah is coming round the wicket now to Malan. And Malan lets this go by, tucking his bat inside his pad. And it whistles through to punt. End of the over, four from it. Malan has four. Hamid, 67. 140 for one. Now, yes, I mean, great forward defences. You've got to have... There's got to be a left-hander on the panel because they have slightly different, often with the ball, you know, coming right arm over to the left-hander.
Who's been a really good left-hander?
John Edrich, probably had a...
John Edrich.
Oh, Graham Smith had a... Not, it was quite an ugly forward defence, but effective, yeah. Gary Kirsten. Are you all right there, Andy? Yeah. You okay? The very mention of the words Gary and Kirsten together.
Why is that?
Just Gothic, Deep has suggested.
Yes, yeah, Just Gothic's a good shout.
Shami continues to Hamid. Hamid defends perfectly into that eight-run circle.
Well, Just Gothic's generally here because he's now the England batting coach, so he could mix two roles, be here to coach and then go and sit on the throne.
Easily do both, can't you? Because once you've set them out, once you've put them out on the field...
Save a few quid, you'll have to pay
get that paid back into the ECB coffers, yes.
Yeah.
You're always thinking you are, Michael.
Gary Kirsten, what's the issue with Gary Kirsten, Andy?
In the one brief period of my life when I had what might be loosely described as a proper job, I took a week off work.
Shami is in. We'll come back to this. And Hamid defends slightly more awkwardly this time, but into the ground off the front foot. It's picked up on the offside, no run.
I took a week off work to go to the Old Trafford test of 1998 against South Africa. and Gary Kirsten scored an 11-hour double century in which he batted as if trying to eradicate the entire concepts of hope and joy from the universe. And, you know, he was undoubtedly a fine and highly skillful player, but as a spectator, particularly an opposition spectator, he could be a tough watch.
Yeah, when he and Graham Smith batted together, that was...
I don't get you, Andy.
Sharma. In bouncer, left alone.
You go into a cage last week at Lords to try and hit fours and sixes and leave the ball and defend the ball. Yet you're not celebrating someone batting 11 hours defending and leaving and just purely just trying to bore the life out of everyone.
Gary,
surely that is what you go to watch cricket for.
Depends who's doing it.
He's just going against his grain here, isn't he?
Well, he is a bit. I've got a bit of sympathy when it comes to Gary Kirsten. Shammy in. He clips this away off his pads. He'll just get a single for it as it runs square of the wicket, the onside.
I think he got a double century in Durban. I was in the England squad. I broke my finger, so I didn't play in the game. And I think Phil has quite a good recollection of rather a lot of balls to Gary Kirsten without getting him out. Durban 2000. Or 99, and I think Mark Butcher might have come on, got him out in the end, bowling off spin.
Oh no!
I'm sure Phil ended up with naught for.
See, that's going to hurt, isn't it?
He bowled a lot of overs, Phil. He looked very tired at the end of it.
They were very effective. I mean, the South Africans produced a lot of very effective, unattractive players. They used to have some very effective, attractive players, didn't they? Barry Richards, Graham Pollock, Mike Proctor. But then you sort of got this Callis Smith.
I love that. Effective, unattractive player.
Yeah.
It should be right-hand effective, unattractive player.
Shammy into Milan, who dabs this ball into the offside, backward of square. Bumrah does the fielding at backward point.
Left-hand, no run. Effective, attractive player. Yeah, yeah. Come on, get Phil's figures up. What were they?
South Africa following on in that game. Just 210 behind in Durban. Boxing Day, so Christmas treat for everyone. Gary Kirsten, 275. That's off 642 balls. Ooh. 878 minutes.
Oh,
that's 14 and a half hours.
Oh, crikey.
To celebrate Christmas. That's glorious, isn't it?
Shammy in, driven at by Milan, loosely and missed. Goes through low to punt around the ankles.
Come on, the figures. Phil Tufnell.
No run. 141 for one. End of the over. Milan 4, Hamid 68.
Tufnell, 45 overs, 6 maidens. None for 117. Kept it tight.
6 maidens, though.
Mark Butcher.
Kirsten, bold Butcher. Butcher, 2 for 32 from 8.2.
Yeah, under bold, you'd have to say.
Oh, very much so. Would have won the test match if they got Butch on earlier.
Well, he did it. He had a few little forays
that week, actually, that me and Phil were in the Holiday Inn where we were staying. I think there was a Guinness bar, an Irish bar underneath, and the Dalai Lama came in. Dalai Lama walked
in. Did he?
Yeah.
Is he a big fan of Guinness?
He was a big fan of Guinness and Gary Kirsten, I think.
That might actually, that probably explains how Gary managed to get into that sort of perpetual position of self-knowledge, mysticism perhaps, a little bit of that. Self-awareness in the bubble. I think tips on the Dalai Lama, that's not fair. As Bumrah is in to the right-handed Hamid, starting you over, thick edge, bounces well in front of second slip. Along the ground, and there's no run. Playing with very soft hands, Hamid.
Yeah, and you know, you look at India yesterday, they were kind of pushing this kind of length and trying to drive this length through extra cover. And even today, Hasib's saying, no, I'm not going to be driving at that delivery. I'm going to defend it and play it with such soft hands that the outside edge is found. It just goes straight into the ground.
Well, his interception point there is where his front pad is, isn't it? Right under his eyes. Bumrah is into him again. And it's a little bit shorter. And he defends just on the back foot. Pushes back to the bowler. No run.
Mohammed Shami's done a good job for India today. 6 overs, 4 maidens, 1 wicket for just 5 runs. Only 2 scoring shots in those 6 overs.
Well, they've needed it. England started at 120 without loss. It's been slow going. 21 runs for the loss of Rory Burns. How many overs were they overnight? I'm sorry, Andy.
42.
So they've had 12.2 overs, going well under 2 and over at the moment. Bumrah into Hamid, who ducks beneath this bouncer. Short ball, really, as opposed to a bouncer, through to punt, and there's no run. That's the problem for India, though, isn't it? Because England have no urgency. I suppose the problem for England might be that having no urgency, they might lose a bit of rhythm in their batting. That's not going to happen, can it?
Well, I just think England have got to set themselves the game plan, batting the whole day out. There'll be times when they have to be patient. There'll be times where they'll score quickly, particularly this afternoon. I think when that second new ball is taken later in the day, it might do a little bit, but it also will be a time to score quickly.
That'll be about 45 minutes after lunch, you would think. As Bumrah is in, that's left alone outside the off stump. Hamid's leaving at the moment very well. There was one just before I came on, you were on, and he definitely left on length as it whistled over middle stump.
Yeah, and I've been impressed with him. They've tried him with a few short balls today, and he's just had none of it. You know, he's just ducked out of the way, swayed out of the way.
Deep was saying earlier that he thought that there needed to be more short balls bowled at him.
They haven't bowled enough at his left shoulder. So the short balls have been kind of beyond his right ear, which is quite a nice short ball to get. It's out of the way. Can't really target him into the armpit yet.
And here comes Bumrah, and that's full, very full, almost a full toss, but defended into the eight-run circle that Michael Vaughan has suddenly invented off the front foot.
I think it'll get passed through.
For the 100, I don't know. I mean, you
100
have,
next year. You're always trying to improve
you have
the 100. Well, yeah.
Have a word with Sangakkara. Kumar's not on the MCC.
Who's going to... No, so it's for the 100 we need it. So who do I send an email to? Sanjay
Patel, Tom
Harrison.
Think so, yeah.
I'll send him an email, just say, come on, bring real entertainment, get the forward defensive.
Bumrah in, that's on the pads again, and that's defended with the full face of the bat up to mid-on.
And he's getting a forward D on in his
no run. This is so exciting. Drinks are now about to be taken. England for 13 overs have added 21 runs for loss of one wicket. Commentary continues on Five Live Sports Extra Digital Radio via the BBC Sport website and BBC Sounds app. But Radio 4 Longwave listeners are leaving us briefly for the shipping forecast. So, yes, streaks have come on the field. Haseeb Ahmed is still there on 68. Milan, 4. The one wicket to fall this morning. Rory Burns bowled. Beautiful ball by Shami. Bowled him for 61. And the ball flew off the top of off stump and came straight over the wicketkeeper's head down to the boundary. It's time for me to take my leave, but Deep Dasgupta has just arrived. So, thoughts on the first hour's play from you, Deep, and then I shall bring in Alison Mitchell.
Thank you so very much. Well, yeah, it's been good. It's been disciplined as compared to what the Indian bowlers did yesterday. I think they were a little bit all over the place yesterday and last night. But they look definitely a lot more disciplined. Again, except for Ishan Sharma, who I think is still struggling to get that rhythm in this test match. Maybe the slope here at Headingley is something that he's not really being able to cope with. But yeah, I mean, so far so good. It's not going to be easy. This still seems to be a good batting surface. And obviously, Hamid's been very, very good. So was Rory Burns initially, but that was a good breakthrough. And Shami, I mean, what a ball that was. Top of off stump, clipping the bails. I think he's looking much, much more attacking today, Mohammad Shami. The length that he's bowled, I think he's got the length going. We keep talking about him being a little unlucky here in England. If you look at him, the way he bowls, as Alison's walked in, Ali, you would look at him and say, oh, he's such a great bowler, especially in these conditions. He should be picking up more wickets. But at times, I think he doesn't really get the length right. Either he's too full or too short for these conditions. But I think this morning, the length that he's bowled is a lot better than what I've seen him bowl right through the series so far.
Hello, Deep. Yeah, it was a beautiful delivery, wasn't it? He felt as if it was going to take a good ball to dislodge one of Burns or Hamid, and the perfect length to hit the top of off. But Burns and Hamid had looked very steady until then. There hadn't been a great deal to threaten. Shami had certainly looked more threatening than Ishant. Were you a little surprised that Bumrah wasn't used at the start of the day?
Very, very surprised, because obviously at that point in time the ball's kind of old, 40 overs, because as a captain you're also thinking about your new ball bowlers, keeping them fresh when the second new ball is due. So I thought, would go with the top two bowlers would be Shami and Bumrah, and I was a little surprised to see Ishant opening the day again with the ball, and he's looked out of colour. I mean, let's be very honest here, he hasn't looked himself at all right through this innings, Ishan Sharma. But yeah, I mean, sooner or later, you'll also see Jadeja coming into bowl, as this is 55 overs old, this ball. Shami's bowling really well, so obviously he's got to be a little careful here now how he uses Shami and Bumrah.
Mm. We welcome back our listeners to Radio 4 Long Wave. With drinks having been taken here at Headingley, overcast day. England 141 for one, so they've lost Rory Burns, and he's bowled for 61. So he resumed his overnight score on 52. England in the first hour have added 21 runs, batted in disciplined fashion. Hamid has been leaving well, beaten only on a couple of occasions I can recall. David Malan got off the mark with a boundary through the covers. But then he also has played one looser drive to Mohammed Shami. He didn't make contact. If he had, then the edge, well, would have gone through to Rishabh Pant. I'm sure it really wasn't far away. But he's got four to his name. Both batsmen have taken the breather during the drinks break as well. So it's a bit of a reset time now. So 141 for one. England's lead on first innings is 63, and it's the left-handed Malan facing up again now to Shami, whose right arm around the wicket to him, angles in, he's up on his toes, fends it down towards gully. One bounce and into the hands of the fielder. Mm-hmm. And I did mention it's overcast here, but quite a bit cooler than it was yesterday. Although, Deep, it's not cold enough to be wearing a scarf. I mean, this is the height of English summer.
Yeah, this is height of winter in Kolkata, where I'm from. So yeah, I mean, it doesn't get less than 15, 16 in Calcutta, height of winter. So yeah, it's quite cold for me.
It's all relative, isn't it?
Yeah.
Shami in now to Malan. He lets that one go and it's come back a treat. It went past that off stump, but it drew hands on heads from Mohammed Shami, and Rishabh Pant had to move quite a little way across to his right hand side to take that. So that has really dragged back quite a long way, and not too far away from the top of that off bail. Very interesting. He's bowled with quite an upright seam. It's nipped.
Yeah, quite a bit, as you mentioned. You know what David Malan is really good at is through covers of his front foot. He drives really, really well. So they've kept the cover region open, inviting him to drive, but the idea would be to push him off on the back foot first.
Knew he got a good one then. Shami's in once more, more confidently, even a safer leave this time, shouldering arms. It was a little wider that time, but Malan's facial expression when that one came back and whizzed by was to make a perfect polo mint with his mouth. Real ooh.
Yeah. So last three deliveries has been back off length, and David Malan has played or left those deliveries off the back foot. So I think that's what Shami is looking at right now. Let's push him off on the back foot and then pitch one up, right up, a little wide-ish outside off stump.
Two slips to the gully as Shami's in, outside the off stump once more, big stride forward and a confident leave by Malan. He's got to be aware of the length of how much the ball is moving. But they do want him driving. Yeah. You know, there's spectators in the crowd wearing hoodies, Deep, so I'll let you off the scarf.
I'm not the only one, yeah? I was feeling cold.
Yeah, it's a day for sort of dark jackets. You know, you look around a crowd and you can sometimes tell it's all very pastel colours and short sleeves. And today it's a sort of darker colour in the crowd. Lots of warmer long sleeve jackets. No rain jackets, though, at least we hope. It's dry, the cloud is high. And Shami is bustling in again to Malan, and he's forward defending slightly fuller length from Shami on off stump. And safely into that offside. Hamid is 68, not out.
Yeah, they've got a shot mid-on as well. I think Andy did mention about how they got Malan out last time he played a test match against India. His leg before. I think that's what they're again, would be looking at. Looking at the field. Got four fielders on the onside. The shot mid-on. A wide-ish mid-on. Rather a mid-wicket and two fielders for the shot delivery on the onside.
Malan waits. Shami is in, driving this time, but only as far as short extra cover. It's fielded securely and there's no run, so a maiden, 141 for one, score remains, and the lead is 63. Yeah, he got 8 and 20 in that last test innings in 2018 against India. And Shami, yes, LBW, and he was caught by Rahane. Of course, he was batting at 4 then, so an elevated position at number 3 now.
Just to pick up on what Deep was saying about Shammy's lengths today, the Cricviz data break lengths into full, good and short. So three categories. Yesterday, Shammy had 15% in what they describe as a full length. Today, 28%, around about the same number of short balls. So he's been pitching much closer to the batsman today than he did yesterday.
Jasprit Bumrah is going to continue from Kirkstall Lane, end of the ground. Hamid, then 68 not out.
That's an interesting field. Five fielders on the onside.
We've got a... It's not quite a short leg, a shortish leg, I'd say. And a leg gully as Bumrah is in there. It's a short ball. And Hamid, though, looks unruffled by it. He ducks underneath it. So got a mid-wicket in place and a long leg as well. Deep backward square, really.
I think all the short balls so far bowl at him, and Warnie did mention about it, were like outside off stump and too short. And what Hamid does really well is the fact that he still looks to come on the front foot, and even though it's a short delivery, would leave it off the front foot.
In goes Bumrah. Bowls now. It's Fuller. It's outside the off stump, and he went to play and half play, half leave. Probably fortuitous that he just drew the hands back at the last moment as the ball went through to Rishabh Pant. Good delivery.
Very good delivery and very good leave as well. Yeah, initially did want to play at it, but did realise that it's shaping away from him. Takes his hands away last moment. But yeah, the short deliveries has to be more towards the body, the ribcage.
Can he trouble Hamid here? His eyes are wide open watching as Bumrah is in now. It's a little fuller on off stump and it's defended. Look to come forward again. Had to bring that front elbow quite high. Angled out towards the gully region. Hamid has just looked so calm really throughout his innings. And he takes a moment, doesn't he? As a lot of batsmen often do. He'll walk away between deliveries. Just take a bit of a breath. But he always looks focused and he's very deliberate about the way he prepares to then face the next ball. He won't rush himself. He won't be hurried. He waits now with bat poised. Bumrah in again. There's a short one and he simply ducks. Really going from the waist down, just ducks the head forward.
And again, if you look at it, he was on his front foot. And that's what you want. Even if you're leaving and you're ducking, you want your body weight going forward, not behind. You still want your body weight on that front foot and not back foot. That's when you get into trouble against the short pitch delivery. But the last one was much better directed, was more towards the body.
Will he go short again? Two more balls in the over. Hamid on 68. Bumrah is in, is short once more. Just back a touch in the previous delivery. And Hamid ducking underneath it again. So two short ones. We go short, short, full. Try and fire one in. It's an intriguing battle now. Bumrah, India's best bowler so far in this match, trying to dislodge England's opener, who's looked so composed throughout his innings so far, getting through to the end of the day alongside Rory Burns last night. He hasn't offered a genuine chance yet this morning, and Bumrah is in outside the off stump. It's wide enough, though, that Hamid's content to leave it well alone. End of the over. Little nod back towards David Malan. Over-negotiated. And maiden at 141 for four.
It was much better over. At least they're trying something else against Hamid, because it just occurs to me they haven't tried enough against Hamid since yesterday. Credit to him. He's batted really, really well. As you were mentioning, he's looked calm. He's looked composed. So, yeah, credit to him. But I just think they have not tried a plan B or a plan C so far. But the last over, obviously, the attempt was to bowl a little bit on the shorter side, try and get him on the back foot as much as possible. Well, as we speak, there's a change in bowling. We've got Mohammad Siraj
placing Shammy.
Yeah. Shammy's spell this morning, 1 for 5 from 7 overs. There have been 3 maidens in a row and just 8 runs for 1 wicket in the last 10 overs.
Well, England, will they feel that as pressure, the batsman? Malan might, because he's back in the team and 4 from 14 so far. He's got to keep that composure. Different challenge now with Siraj, but Shammy's been excellent from that rugby stand end of the ground. It's the first time we're seeing Siraj today.
Yeah, I think the biggest challenge as far as David Malan is concerned is how he paces his innings. He's playing test match cricket after a while in between since 2018, and now he's been such a successful white ball cricketer.
Yeah, it's interesting hearing his take on how you balance those two forces. As Siraj is in, he's flashed at that one, and it's well wide, behind backward point for four. He stood up tall, knowing Gully was there, backward point, hit it firm enough, and just fractionally, unfortunately for Milan, he was placed in the right spot as well.
Well, I guess this is what has made him so successful in white ball cricket, is playing his shot, especially outside off stump, whether it's driving off the front foot or, you know, square cutting. And this is, I think that's how he's going to play his innings here as well. At least he seems to be a lot more proactive and ready to play his shots.
It's his second boundary. Two slips in the gully. Siraj in again. It's outside off, but he's playing more defensively this time. Into the cover region. Finds a fielder and no run. Because he's only played four first-class matches in the last 2 years. We had three in the 2020 season. Mm-hmm. Of course, just the one this summer back in June, where he did score 199 on this ground. And prior to that, it was a double 100 on this ground in August of 2020. But one thing that he would feel is that the white ball cricket, the intensity that brings, you've got to take that forward to a test match. Outside the off stump, same result, flashed away, four more. Closer to the gully region than backward point this time, but through the gap and down to the boundary. So eight runs off Siraj's opening over here.
Yeah, poor delivery again, short and wide, and that's what he thrives on, short and wide, gets another boundary. But India can't afford these loose deliveries, as you mentioned. Two boundaries already. Now they've got a deep point, the backward point now.
Yeah, trying to protect that region, which they don't want to be doing. They want to have catchers in wicket-taking position. Siraj is in. It's outside the off stump, left alone by Milan. Probably a fraction too close to his body to attempt the same shot, and he'd be aware that the fielder has gone back now.
Now, that's the danger with someone like Mohammad Siraj and the kind of mindset that he has. I mean, he's always attacking. And I think I mentioned this yesterday as well. So there's always this danger of him leaking a few runs.
Yeah, Milan's spoken about just the intensity of the last couple of years. And he's done a lot of quarantining in the time. He's barely had a break from cricket since last November. Siraj in, pushed across him from over the wicket and left alone by Milan, taken by Rishabh Pant. And he's a very open and honest cricketer, Milan. He can wear his heart on his sleeve quite a bit in interview. He's not afraid of saying what he feels about a situation, which is really quite sort of upfront and refreshing. Some might feel that there's a bit of oversharing that can be done, but he's not afraid to speak about how when you're stuck in hotel quarantine, little things can become big things. You can start to get irritated by things which big picture wise are really not important. He's settling now and waiting as Siraj is over the wicket to him, and he defends coming forward. Ball rolls into the offside. It's picked up. No run to end the over. So a couple of flashing boundaries from Milan's moved him on to 12 off 20. England's lead is 71, 149 for one.
Yeah, I think he's a great addition to this English side, David Milan, because obviously he's got a lot of runs. He's been so successful in at least white ball cricket, and that's what you need in that dressing room right now. That experience, that confidence of scoring runs, and I think he brings that to the table. Yeah. I think I really like him because he's also very compact in his game, in his the way he bats.
I think at the age of 33, he very much knows his game now. I think there can be a lot of questioning yourself when you're young, when you're younger. Am I good enough to be here? And I think now he really does know that he is, feels that he is, and he's just defending a ball that comes back in on him a fraction. Bumrah is operating again from Kirkstall Lane, end of the ground.
Yeah, and talking about bubbles, I've been part of some bubble or the others since 2020 September. I can tell you, it can't be easy. When you're in bubbles for 2 months, 2.5 months at a stretch, away from family, you can't do much, you're stuck within the hotel, your room, and not just hotel, a few segments in that hotel.
Yeah, we had it just from a broadcast sense last year for maybe 2 months as Bumrah's in on that, struck him on the body, he's ducked into it. He caught him on the, I'm not sure whether that caught him on the top of the arm.
I think helmet.
Oh, it was the helmet, was it?
That's
and then it
the
went
reason,
away towards leg gully.
Yeah, that's the reason calling for the physio. And that's the delivery that you want to bowl at him.
Oh, yeah, right off the back of the helmet as well. He's not actually. Has he got the stem guard on the back of the helmet? Yeah, that's caught him sort of on the rear part. And a glancing blow. You see his flowing hair out the back of the helmet, but I couldn't see that he's got that additional stem guard. I don't think he has. But the physio will come out and just make sure that there's no concussion impact. 149 for one, and the lead is 71. So out comes the physio. That might be a good time for me to hand over to Aggers. Then there's a bit of a break in play here. Milan on 12 and Hamid on 68. So England still looking to build their lead with 40 minutes to go until lunch. Only the one wicket has fallen then so far, and that of Rory Burns. But Deep Dasgupta, to hear another few words from you, and Aggers is coming in here.
Yeah, I guess that's a good plan against him. Hamid, though, it seems like he's all right. Yeah, the physio is out. He's going to ask him a few questions, the usual protocol. You know, what's his name, where he is. Yeah, he seems to be all right. He's smiling. But yeah, he's been really, really good so far. But that's something that Indian bowlers haven't tested him enough with, that short pitch delivery or short pitch delivery aimed at his body.
I agree with you, Deep. It's been a great surprise for me. I mean, he plays beautifully on the front foot. He's got all the time in the world, and he hasn't looked ruffled the least bit. And I know, once anyone get hit, of course, but short pitch bowling is part of the game, and they haven't tried him out at all to see how he fares against that. Apart from the occasional short ball, and he's swayed away well, but a full on hostile attack just to take him out of that comfort zone that he's living happily in at the moment.
No, that's a good question. I mean, Aggers, for you, I mean, is as a bowler, someone like Hamid, you don't want to bowl bouncers at him. You actually want to bowl short pitch.
Sure.
Right? Because he's not someone who's going to take on the bouncer at all. He doesn't pull. I haven't really seen him pull.
No, he just sways out of the way, doesn't he?
Exactly.
He's wearing a huge chest pad, but the Indians haven't had a go at it yet. But he's got it on there for a reason. It's like a bit of a target. That's where they want to be trying. And it's a better field for that now. They have got their legs slip, and they've got the short leg. But he's fine. I mean, he's been checked over there by the physio, and he'll have changed his helmet and so on. But sometimes you've got to try and drag a batsman out of this world that he's happily living in. And that's why people have a go verbally sometimes and say things, and just to try and distract as much as anything else. Yeah. So interesting to see how he plays now. There's leg slip, forward short leg, there's a mid-wicket, there's a man out behind square on the leg side in case he does take on the short ball. One slip and a fine gully. He's remarking his guard as if he was starting again. But he's not, he's on 68 and he's played very well. 149 for one is the score. He did give that chance yesterday, which took him to 50. And Sharma didn't get a hand on one at second slip. Now, what's Bumrah going to do here? Looking at the field, he's going to bowl short term. Leg slip crouching, and that forward short leg as Bumrah runs in and bowls is full. It's the bluff, and it hits him on the pad. There's an appeal. Umpire Wharf says, no, I'm not interested. And neither really is Bumrah. Now, quickly turned around there and walked off.
The short pitch delivery, or the barrage so far in the last over and this one, will also make that fuller delivery lot more effective as well, because at this point in time he's going to be thinking about the short pitch delivery, so he's not going to be as committed on the front foot as he was before.
Yep, go half and half, find the edge, and that's the sort of the plan that the bowler will be thinking about here. Bumrah runs in, bowls short, sways out of the way, dips at the knee. Good hostile fast bowling, but played very well. Wasn't quite straight enough to produce the fend or whatever it is that they're going to try and get here. But that was the right sort of length. Hamid 68, Milan has made a good start. He's on 12. And Hamid settles over his bat again. There's two balls left in this over. Bumrah creeps in. Now he's there. He bowls, and that's very well played. Very well played by him. He's getting very comfortably onto the front foot. And there's so much time playing it towards a bit off, and Milan comes down the pitch, and I'm sure he's saying exactly what we're saying. That's really well played. You go, you hit on the head, you've got the short pitch field. Yeah. To get a stride in like that.
As a batter, you've got to keep telling yourself, still look to get forward, look to get forward.
Bat raised is waiting. Bumrah launches into another one. Oh no, he almost nibbled this one outside the off stump. Ball flew past the edge of the bat. Might just have taken it out of the way in time. We shall see. But it was a good hostile over from Bumrah, which again adds to the surprise. I think many of us felt. I don't know what you felt about Ishant Sharma opening up this morning rather than Bumrah, who just seems so dangerous.
Absolutely. And if you look at numbers, and Andy, if you can help me out with this, when Bumrah and Shami are bowling in tandem, they're picking more wickets, aren't they? I mean, and if you can find that out, but I just get a feeling when they are together, bowling together, I think they seem to be a lot more dangerous as well.
Milan's on strike and is facing Siraj, who comes running up and bowls to him. He lets that go outside the off stump. There's some bounce. Almost knocked punt off his feet as Milan plays no stroke. And Milan is in outstanding form. Have you seen his recent figures? His last two first-class innings.
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely outstanding.
Yeah.
219, 199. I mean, he's cut out both on this ground. I mean, he comes into this game in incredible red form, red ball form. He's waiting now. In comes Siraj. He must be seeing it like a football. He goes on the back foot, plays into the offside. Of course, the 219 was made last August. And his most recent first-class innings, his 199, was in June this year. Talk about the mad schedule, and there you have it.
True, but, I mean, leave the red ball cricket aside. Even in white ball cricket, he's been scoring a lot of runs.
I'm being a little bit sarcastic. But it does prove the point, I think.
Yeah, fair enough.
Those are his last two first-class innings. And comes Siraj, and he bowls outside the off stump, and Milan lets that go through. His experience, and he is hitting the ball well in limited overs cricket. He's still the number one rated T20 cricketer in the world, the batsman anyway. So, but this is all a bit different. And to get into the rhythm, the flow of Test cricket. Mm.
But I think he's experienced enough to make that mental adjustment as well. And someone in his early 30s, matured, has played a lot of cricket.
Waiting now, Siraj on his way, bowls and squares him up a little. He plays to mid wicket, goes a defensive stroke, no run, 149 for one. Chilly day, it's not as warm as yesterday. It's a bit of a northerly bite to the breeze coming over Headingley. So the spectators here dressed accordingly. Including Dickie Bird, I've just seen on the screen. He's got an enormous wind cheater on. Chatting away to Ashley Giles. What a character, dear old Dickie. Yeah. Just loves cricket. Lives for cricket. 149 for one. Siraj goes round the wicket now. And that's a little deflection down the leg side. Pant can't get to it. And in fact, he's off the body anyway, or off the pad. For a moment there's some excitement that it might have come off the glove or the bat. Leg by as it is, the 150 comes up. Yeah. England's lead stretches on now to 75.
I've got to be very, very careful there, India. The lead, as you mentioned, 75. I was looking at some stat last night that India's only won once after conceding a 100-plus run lead.
Ever?
Ever. Way back in 1981, Melbourne, if I'm not wrong.
Oh, well. Siraj rushes in and bowls outside the off stump. Is dabbed away off the back foot by Milan, but only as far as gully. And it's 153 for one. The lead 75. Milan has 12. Hamid has 68. The man out today celebrating his birthday was Rory Burns, who was bowled by Shami. Played rather round, a pretty straight ball, really. It trimmed the bales. He was out for 61. Now, presumably, we're going to see a resumption of this short pitch attack from Bumrah to Hamid. Pant's shouting there something as he walks past. And still Joe Root waits. And I wonder when the last time was. That, just say a wicket fell now. That the last time Root came into bat. Well, say with more than 150 on the board. I can't think when that might have been. Andy will know. In goes Bumrah. Starts a new over, and that finds the edge as Hamid probes forward. Runs away down into that offside. Bumrah's pointing. He wants a bit of a field change here by the look of it. In fact, he wants a leg slip taking out. Where's he going to go? He's going to go into the offside, yeah. And the short leg actually goes to leg slip. So taking the short leg out, which is surprising.
Yeah.
Put him in the leg slip is still there, but they've gone for the extra orthodox slip.
Or maybe just take the mid-wicket fielder off and put it in short square leg.
What's hit on the head in the last over? 153 for one. And goes Bumrah. Bowls full. And that goes whistling through. Definitely more pace in the pitch today. And the punt was almost blown off his feet there by that one. Rattled into his gloves. 153 for one.
I'll put that in the intro. Aggers have got a few on the go. The India winning after conceding a 100-run deficit. They've won three games, but I think only one when they've batted first.
Oh.
Leg slip crouching, hands on knees. Bumrah stutters, he's there now, bowls short. Again, it's a beautifully played by Hamid. Punt again off his feet as he gathers that. It's a hostile spell, this. And definitely the ball going through at a rapid pace to Bumrah.
The one where they won after batting first, that game in Melbourne, February 1981. India 237, Australia 419. India then 324, and Australia skittled for 83. The other two come to after this ball.
Hamid waits. A few taps at the crease. Now he stands up, bat raised. Bumrah on his way. Bowls. And so easily played on that front foot again by Hamid. He just has so much time.
A match in the West Indies in 1976. West Indies 359, India 228. West Indies declared 271 for 6, and India 406 for 4 to win by 6 wickets.
That's an amazing win.
Yeah. And the other one was the one of the most unforgettable tests of all time in Kolkata in March 2001.
Who scored the runs in against the West Indies then? Gavaskar must have.
Yeah, must have been.
Must have got some. That's an incredible win. This is turned by Hamid to mid wicket. And the score remains 153 for 1, Hamid 68, Malan has 12. And to beat the West Indies at home in 1976 with a deficit like that.
So Gavaskar 102, Amarnath 85, Gundappa Viswanath 112, both of them run out as well.
Really? So who was bowling for the West Indies? I thought it was Bumrah first of all. On his way, bowls short. Better line, but Hamid plays it well, ducking right underneath it, twiddles his bat, says I'm happy with that, and it's the end of the over. 153 for one.
It was largely a spin attack for West Indies. Bernard Julian all round a bowl 13 overs, young Michael Holding 21 wicketless
spinner
overs. Then Albert Padmore, Imtiaz Ali and Rafiq Jumadeen made up the bulk of the overs.
I'm going to go downstairs and I'm going to tell Michael Holding that our statistician has just referred to him as a spinner.
I didn't say he was a spinner. I was just in the other two who weren't spinners. And then so largely spinner.
Right. And where was it?
In Trinidad in 1970. Okay. And I think
it would have turned
a game that then did influence the West Indies then prioritising
the quick
pace.
That wasn't the series in which Bishan Bedi threw the towel in, was it? Was that the series? I think India were about six down or something, and Bish didn't fancy batting, certainly not, and the white towel was lobbed out from the dressing room when the game was over. Siraj on his way, bowls short of a length. Malan stands up, plays that easily, and Siraj kicks it away to be picked up at mid-wicket. Michael Holding, a spinner, Evan.
I did not say.
I'm going to tell him. I'm going to text him right now.
I don't think it was very clear at all.
I'm going to text him right now.
An attack made up almost entirely of spinners. Michael Holding.
Can we get a transcript of what I actually said?
Bernard Julian was no slouch either. Oh, big Bernard. He had enormous strides. Bowled for years for Kent. Siraj bowling. Beautifully driven by Malan. Just in front of square. Another speed away over the practice pitches. And into the cover boundary for four. Any width. And he just dispatches it very easily. 16 not out. And England now to 157 for one.
Quickly, Bumrah's bowled four consecutive maidens to Haseeb Hamid, who has scored just three from his last 50 balls.
Wow.
Oh, loosening the shackles there, Malan. That's exactly where he loves it. Just outside the off stump, can get on the front foot. Only really a short extra cover So plenty of space if you get the one that you can get your hands through.
We're talking on the telly about the short pitch to Hamid, mm. and then they've started doing it now. Or to an extent. But he's played it pretty well. 157 for one. Siraj on his way. Bowls. Milan defends. Wants a single. Yeah, that's good running. Hamid responds immediately. Just a quick glance at each other. And an immediate response. The lead goes to 80.
The other thing we're both saying is just how late they play it. It's almost like they play it onto their toes. So late. And I think it's just, it makes them look like they've got so much time. India here, they're trying to put their best foot forward, but England just look so comfortable at the crease.
That was the first single for eight overs.
Wow.
Well, they've changed ends then. So Hamid can have a look at Siraj. There's a deep square leg, two slips, although they're standing quite far apart. As Siraj moves in, bowls, and he again stretches into that forward defensive shot.
It's almost like you're watching the same shot on rinse and repeat, and he just gets into the perfect front foot defence, and again, he's drilled that nicely.
Not often is the opening batsman get onto that front foot so easily and play it from there. 158 for one. Siraj runs in eagerly, bowls a bounce, so it's very high. And Hamid again has no trouble with that. It's the question of how he plays around the rib cage, I guess, but at the moment, really playing well.
They've bowled a few short balls. It just hasn't felt threatening enough. And what I mean by that is some have been a little bit wide, that one a bit short. If they get that radar, get it in the armpit region, then you can sort of test out an awkward length.
Hamid waits. Siraj is there. He bowls to him. Played off the front foot once again, carefully to mid-wicket. He looks, checks where everything is. He really works on his footwork. You can see him looking at it. He very deliberately walks into his stance, makes sure everything is in the right place. He plays the shot and checks everything is as it should be. He's meticulous about his batting. And now he's having a chat with Milan. They've got 25 minutes, a bit less than 24 actually, to go to lunch on the second day. It's been England's morning again, really just to make sure that they nailed it down. It hasn't been spectacular by any means, but just doing what has to be done.
What's been added overnight, Andy? Sorry.
38 in 20 overs for one wicket.
It's not electric pace by any, they're not blazing them around, but equally they've just controlled, really.
Just doing the job.
Yeah.
And it's up to India to try and do something, to take some wickets. And now Kohli's turning to Jadeja, who hobbled off last night and didn't come back. So he was bothered by something. It might have been his knee.
Yeah, he did that bit of fielding, didn't he? On the outfield.
Well, it's only got men around the bat. There's a slip. Backward short leg. Forward short leg. He's going to bolt over the wicket into the rough. And Milan comes down the pitch straight away and pads that away. Picked up by Siraj at backward point. We saw one yesterday to Burns really kick out of the rough. It's only early days as far as the pitch and the rough is concerned, but the left-hander can never be entirely confident about what happens when the ball lands outside his off stump. Jadeja bowls, and again he just thrusts a right pad at the ball. 158 for one.
He's so fast between balls, isn't he? Just turns and goes, turns and goes.
Shirt hanging out, Jadeja bowls again. Milan this time plays it, driving on the bounce back to the bowler. Mid-on's quite deep down here. Mid-off is up. There's a man out on the sweep. Jadeja again over the wicket, tosses that one up, turned away into the leg side. There's an easy one there. 159 for one. Milan to 18. At least to put on 24 since Burns has bowled by Mohammed Shami. Careful tapping of the pitch there by Hamid. He's found a little spot of something that he's attending to. Now we go through this business with the guard again.
What's he taking? Middle, maybe?
Yeah. Raking away at the ground again. Then he'll take a step further up the pitch, to some more raking and then another pace up the pitch and some raking. It's not quite got the Jonathan trots, but there's something there like it. In goes Jadeja, bowls to him, right forward he comes. Okay, the angle of the bat sending the ball straight into the ground.
I see how he's shaping up. I think his toes might be a little bit more on middle and off.
Jadeja again. Bowls. Oh, it's bowled him, has it?
Yeah.
It has. Well, that's an absolute beauty. Where on earth's that come from? He stood there. He's covering the stumps. That's why I'm sounding surprised. But that's somehow crept through that immaculate-looking defence and bowled him. And I'm looking forward to seeing this again, frankly. It was a... it just spun past the outside edge. It was an absolute beauty, and that's taken everyone by surprise, including I think Hamid, who he didn't move for a moment. It's as if he was just astonished. He's out for 68 and it was a very good innings.
Well, he's batted beautifully, we have to say. He's calmed down the threat that there was of England losing early wickets. He's looked very stylish, very compact and very organised. However, that one just genuinely snuck through. He looked like he did everything right. He shaped up right, just a fraction of turn, and he was coming quite wide with that left arm bowling. Just took the clip on top of off. So a beautiful delivery in the end. And it has seen him go, but arguably England now in a strong position, route to the crease, and Milan starting to establish himself. So, Dan, the game is now moving.
It's moving. It's moving. What's so weird about that is I looked on the replay and I couldn't still work out how... Because it covered the off stump. I couldn't see a stump.
Yeah.
And it did straighten a bit. But if it straightened, you kind of think, well, surely therefore it's going to miss the stump.
Yeah.
But it didn't. It snaked around it and then clipped the stump. So, yes, poor old Hamid's got to go for 68. How many dot balls, Andy, did he face towards it? Because I seem to remember he was on 68 quite a long time ago.
Mm. He had 68 off 166, finished with 68 off 195. So he had 28 dot balls before that wicket and three from his last 54 balls before the ball that just missed him. Overall, he had 68 from 194 with 12 fours.
Thank you. It was a fine knock. And a bit again, we're looking at the replay and it's almost sort of still defies your understanding. Can't quite work out how it's out.
That's Jadeja's first wicket of the series with the last ball of his 50th over.
Thank you.
Well, one thing I would say, though, Dan, is this game is set up how we want to see England bat. Runs on the board when Root comes to the crease. Hopefully, down the line, on paper, Butler and Moeen can cash in. So, on paper, it's still set up.
Yes. Oh, it's set up all right, but India will be really pleased with their morning's work, won't they, as Bumrah has switched ends to the far end, the emerald stand end. He's into the left-handed Milan. Oh, who gets an edge on it? Does he? It's come off a bit of pad and is taken at first slip. Umpire Kettleborough is unmoved. Coley is wondering about referring. He's shaking his head and they've decided no. So, yeah, that went sort of between bat and pad. The angle with Bumrah from around the wicket. Oof. And that's hit the top of the thigh. Has been taken by Coley at slip, but just seeing a replay on that. It's very close to his gloves, a bit of handle, maybe shoulder of the bat, but not out. We continue. Two sips and a gully. In place, extra mid-off, mid-on, mid-wicket. Bumrah in to Milan, who drives, but loosely off the inside half of the bat. Up to mid-on, and there's no run. Now then, overthrows, extraordinary overthrows. Milan's going to pick up four. Well, that was extraordinary. I'll have to explain. Milan, after he'd played that slightly false drive, it went up to mid-on. Mid-on then threw the ball back sort of fairly lazily, really, and it bounced in front of second slip and ran down to the boundary, the deep third boundary, I guess it is. And Milan's picked up four runs. It'll go in the book as another boundary for Milan. I think his fifth.
He'll always take it. Is it Siraj doing the damage here? That was just loose. It's one of those things, you stood in the field all day and you need to be switched on. Jasper will not be happy.
Especially when you've just taken the wicket as well. And England they have gone nowhere really. 43 runs this morning in 21.2 overs. Four of those overthrows just now. So, whilst England are playing to their game plan, India have restricted
England perhaps more than the home side would have wanted. As Bumrah is in to Milan. Milan defends a short ball out into the offside. It's picked up by Bumrah off his own bowling. He doesn't want anyone to know. He's picked up the ball. The fielder's come towards him. He said, no, go away from me. I'm cheesed off. I've just conceded four runs that I had no right to concede. It was totally wrong.
Yeah.
Bowlers are funny onions, aren't they?
Bowlers hate that. You know, they charge in, they put in the hard work, put the body on the line, and then someone who's not concentrating just loops it.
I mean, frankly, Siraj should be happy. It's not Catherine Brunty's having to deal with at this point.
She's a shocker.
Bumrah in. That's dabbed down, played, steered almost to the gully along the ground by Milan off the back foot, and there is no run. So, yes, it's been a slightly torturous morning for both sides, really. They didn't. Ishant Sharma opened, didn't really get much out of the pitch.
Odd that he opened, really.
Wasn't it?
I thought Bumrah was very obvious choice. And actually, I'd say he looks quite effective today as well. Shami got in there with the wicket as well.
How many overs has Bumrah bowled this morning, Andy? He turns and runs in towards Milan, and Milan defends into the onside, up to mid-on. Will there be four more? No. This time Siraj just holds the ball. And now rubs it on his trousers. Bumrah has not looked at Siraj since the event.
Yeah, he's looking the other way.
Pointedly
the
other way.
Don't even throw the ball to me.
Okay, right, give it. And now the crowd are cheering because Siraj managed to throw the ball to Bumrah without it going for four overthrows. Right. Slightly disgruntled Bumrah comes in now to complete his 19th over of this innings. And Milan gets thick inside edge. It squirts into the onside. Brings him a single. And Jadeja does the fielding. One more to the total at the end of the over. England 164 for 2. Milan 23. Root yet to face a ball, Andy.
Bumrah's first spell this morning was 6 overs for 5 with 4 consecutive maidens to Hamid. Shami also conceded 5 from 7 overs. So between them, they've kept it tight.
Yep. It's been Siraj and Sharma have conceded what runs have been.
Yes, Sharma conceded 11 from 4. Siraj, 13 from 3. Also, 4 leg byes, which didn't go against the bowler.
No, they
should.
Scrabble
down the leg side. 4 overthrows there. Go against the bowler.
You know my feelings, Andy. You know my feelings about leg byes. And I'm excoriated by this many by people.
What's your...
Well, look, and partly this comes into my mind when I see white ball cricket. So especially, I watched an IPL game as Jadeja starts a new over and Milan goes back to his crease, pushes the onside, no run. And the bowler, the first over, bowled 2 balls down the leg side, it flicked the pad and went for 4. And then he got cut for 4 and conceded another couple. In comes Jadeja, pushed into the onside by Milan, no run. So he'd actually conceded 14 runs for his team. But when he's coming to get contract negotiations end of the year, that over went for 6. His economy rate's fine, isn't it? As Jadeja is in, pushed down to the offside by Milan, he finds the gap, finds a single. 24, he moves to 165 for 2. And I think it just doesn't show how when a bowler bowls errant deliveries down the leg side, they're disbenefiting their team.
You're comfortable with traditional buys, no problem. That's the keeper should clean that up. It's coming straight down the line.
The
leg side, you've bowled a bad delivery. You should get punished.
I do agree that.
Yeah,
I mean,
I
go so far as to give it to the batter as well, but that's because as a batter of limited ability, I need every run. Yeah, because I got my leg in the way. I got my leg in the way. I deflected it down to the boundary.
Even I got as runs a batter who would team. Like extra runs, I like runs. I haven't got a bat on it. Like the job is to... score runs.
Clues in the job name.
No, the job is to score runs for your team, and if you do it using your leg, you get runs when it comes off the inside edge and onto the leg. Pushed into the offside by Root. His first ball is underway straight away. Just playing it square of the wicket in the offside.
That's so Joe Root, isn't it? Busy, great use of the feet. Straight off the mark, just back, sees the gap, punches it, goes.
Great judgment of length, isn't it?
He uses his feet well, doesn't he? Depth of crease, gets forward, gets back, knows where the gap is.
Hard for a slow bowler to bowl at him, isn't it? As Milan drives up to mid-on, goes for a quick single, but he's picked the fielder there at mid-on, and they've come through for that single easily. It's Mohammed Shami. He was a little deep.
These little bits, I think, hurt as a team. It's like you're already up against it. And then straight away you're trying to apply new pressure, new batter at the crease, and they're just knocking you around, making you look a little bit sluggish.
Yep. And I agree. Jadeja in, short, whipped away by Root. He's going to pick up a couple here as he plays it back to the square on the onside. Again, great judgment of length, just knew to go into the back foot, tuck it around the corner. Siraj, every time Siraj throws the ball, now you'll know when Siraj is fielding because the Western Terrace will give him huge cheers. Two more to the total at the end of that over that went for a few, Andy. 169 for two, Milan 25, Root 3, 5 off the over without really trying. That's what you mean, isn't it?
Yeah, it's almost milking them, right? And even their good balls, you're just finding a length that you can knock away. It's a skill set. Do you know what they're going to be eyeing up? A cup of tea. And do you know what I've learnt this test match?
No.
That Andy Zaltzman is a tea connoisseur.
Did you not know?
Well, I've discovered he gave me one of his favourite oolong teas today, and me who love tea, and come with my loose leaf maker anyway. I've been blown away by the skill set.
He's like kind of he's like the English Adam Zampa, you know. Adam Zampa's obsessed with coffee.
Oh yeah.
He's like in England, it's more tea thing, isn't it? So he's sort of like our Adam Zampa. Bournemouth starts a new over, and that's defended at the offside of the front foot by Milan. Goes straight to cover. There's no run.
He's bought a couple, so I've tasted one, and it was arguably one of the best teas I've ever had. I think there's one more to come. Is there one more you brought?
I've got a few.
You've got a few. Yeah.
He's very particular about it as well. I mean, if he has to have bog standard tea, it's always two bags. Always two bags left in for an inordinate amount of time.
Needs a strong brew.
Oh, he does, yeah. No, really does.
I've been impressed.
Boomer around the wicket, left-handed Milan. Two slips in, and he lets this go by close to the off stump. There are oohs and ahs. There are 10 minutes to go until lunch. India would love another wicket. England have added just the 49.
One more.
Yes.
And where would you judge the morning? So I'm just thinking the fact that they haven't got away.
Yep.
And if they snuck one more in, three for the session. Would that pip it over towards India? For the session.
I think if you look at the session in pure raw session terms, you'd say that this is India's session. If it hadn't been for the context of the match.
Yeah.
49 for two in all these overs. Milan works this ball up to mid on. Siraj back to field.
he picks
holds
it up.
And there's no run. So there have been 23.3 overs.
Mm.
They've got rid of both overnight batters.
Yeah, their body language looks better. They're just starting to bounce around a little bit more.
Their problem is they've got such a deficit. I mean, yesterday was so epically bad for them. As Andy said over dinner last night, he posed the question, have you ever seen a team underperform as badly as that? You know, even when your best fielder is misfielding and then twisting his knee at the act of doing it. It's like sort of emblematic of all that's gone wrong yesterday.
When they were
for India.
Bowled out against Australia for 36?
That's bad, yes.
And they came back and won that.
True. Bumrah in. Oh, driven at. Missed. Goes through very low to punt.
Very, very full ball there. Right on the crease line. Milan, I don't know what he was trying to do. I think maybe he's looking as if he's trying to score, but equally trying to dig it out at the same time. Not quite a convincing shot, and it just scooted along the surface.
He's sort of already in credit, though, for an England number three. So he's got 25. What's the England's number three average this summer? I got a raised eyebrow there, did you see? Here's Bumrah. And Milan just gets up on his toes and dabs it. Oh, what's a single? They're going to go through for a single. In the end, it was an easy one. Milan doesn't quite know why Root didn't set off instantly. He played it through backward point. And then there was a little bit of a fumble in the field. There, for a moment, both batters were in mid-pitch talking to each other.
There was a run there. It felt like there was a run. But yes. Joe Root, he was running, but also saying no at the same time.
Yeah, it's not helpful, though.
It's not helpful. Yeah, they got away with it.
170 for two. 50 runs have come up now this morning.
Before today, England's number threes this summer had aggregated 63 runs in 8 innings at an average of 7.8.
Wow.
So 26 feels like positive riches. Bradman-esque. But it is.
And Joe Root can really settle in on this.
Well, he can. He's got 7 minutes till lunch. Two slips and a gully in. Bumrah in. And bowls a really full length delivery, which is dug out by Root, much to the appreciation of the crowd. End of the over. Another Bumrah over gone. 20 overs, none for 30 he's bowled. 170 for two after 66 overs. And this is part of the game within a game, isn't it? England have... Well, these two teams have got another test match back-to-back. And in a sense, England just want to get as many overs into the legs of the Indian bowlers as they possibly can, don't they, in this innings?
Yeah, wear them down, get some runs for themselves. Let's be honest, it's been a pretty dry time for everybody but Joe Root, so it gives that opportunity to be out of the middle, build some confidence, wear the Indians down, and then hopefully have a pretty large victory if they can score big, ideally one innings, but at least set themselves up for that.
Jadeja starts a new over and Milan cuts him away, but can't beat backward point, who dives well to his left. Siraj can't prevent the run in the end. At a full stretch dive, got his left hand to it, parried it, otherwise it would have gone for four.
I was looking around all the fielders, everyone was clapping except Jasprit Bumrah.
He's not letting it lie.
You should have done that on my ball, the one you let through, mate.
Well, even worse than that, it just tossed it away. Alistair Cook was the recipient of two sets of four overthrows that took him to 100. One from Mohammed Asif, 2010 at the Oval, and the other one that we saw together in his final test. Jadeja in, that's worked into the onside but picked up at short leg. This day, and I have you to thank.
Yeah, down at the Oval, you were going off on one, and I was like, Dan.
You were yanking at my arm. Jadeja in, driven into the offside, short extra cover picks up. Kohli stationed in there, close in, no run. Jadeja rushing through these overs here. In again, and Root drives again to Kohli on the bounce. Short extra. Kohli trying to energise his team here.
Just fired that back into Pant, didn't he, after fielding the ball with that sort of energy that says, come on.
Root's now doing a bit of gardening. Because I think he'd like there to be one more over after this before lunch. He works his next ball into a gap on the onside. It's a beautiful piece of batting, even though it's only going to get him two runs. Because it's a packed onside field with a short leg, backward square leg, a mid-wicket, and then a tighter mid-wicket. And he's just found, easy as you like, the back foot. Push that, that's two. Low-risk shot, moves to five.
It's not often you see that shot. I think people holding their shape, punching the ball off the back foot through that mid-wicket region. Often you see the bat face close or the balance lost.
Round a wicket, and a short leg becomes mid-off as Root drives into the offside. A wild throw comes in from Bumrah. It's sort of semi-taken by punt. They get through for a single. 174 for two. Milan 27. Root will keep striking. He has six. There are 4 minutes to go. And in situations like this, Ebony, I've always... Oh, sorry, Andy, you wanted to say something, and then I was going to ask Ebony about...
Just a little niche stat on how England have found their new Hodgs and Sutcliffe in Burns and Hamid. Both made 60, both bowled out. It's only the fifth time in England's test history that their openers have both made 60 and been bowled. And three of them were Hobbs and Sutcliffe.
Oh, well, this bodes very well.
In the mid-1920s. The other was Gooch and Atherton against Pakistan in 1992. It's a niche stat, but there we are. Hobbs and Sutcliffe back in the England team.
How do you go looking for these things? Is it like an idea comes in your head and you think, I'm going to go and see if I can find the answer?
It's a curse as much as a gift.
I can imagine you waking up in the middle of the night. I wonder.
Well, Mohammed Shami is going to bowl what really ought to be the last over before lunch. Back into the attack, replacing Bumrah from the Emerald stand end. He's into Root. Root is wrapped on the pad, but the ball is always snaking past the off stump, and it rolls up to the offside. No run. It's what I was going to ask you, Ebony, because you strike me as being a little bit like me, a bit tricksy in these matters. So if you need to get through to lunch.
Yeah.
And you need to waste a bit of time. I mean, there's the classic, there's the gardening.
Yeah.
And if you get your partner, the non-strikers, in today, a bit of synchro
thigh
gardening.
Thigh pad needs sorting out.
Bit of thigh pad, but the most obvious one is just taking guard. Oh, I'll tell you how in a minute. Shami into Root, who guides this quite deliberately down to the boundary for four, past a diving second slip. It sometimes looks with Root like, was that a false shot? But actually, when you watch it again, you'll see he's He's happy to play into the ground, the gap between second slip and sort of fourth slip. And it must be so annoying for the bowler, because that's with the full face of the bat, isn't it?
Yeah, and the cool thing, he doesn't let his bat get too far away from his body. He just kind of lets it come late, 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 and then just slightly opens that face down into the surface.
And also because they like to have quite widely spaced slips to root, because they know he's playing in that direction, so it sort of goads him into it. 178 for two with that boundary. Shammy in, driven nicely up to mid on, no run. So, when you take guard,
yeah,
frequently you take guard, deliberately trying to get it close to where you want the guard to be.
Yeah.
But actually, if you're trying to waste a bit of time, you put it, you know, you want two, you put it on middle and off.
Yeah.
Just go towards you a bit more, and you just do it
just
slowly.
Keep going.
And then when you get close to it, just overshoot. No, away from you. No, you've gone too far.
Also,
hold your bat up straight.
Also, you want one for your front foot and your back foot, so you might go right.
Yeah. Shammy into Root, who just guides this again sublimely down to the boundary for four. It's such a compact, undemonstrative shot, but he just waits for it, plays it late. This time it was a lot squarer. It was more down to sort of deep backward point. He finds the gap again, moves to 14. England were sort of becalmed and going nowhere until... really, until Root came in, it's a bit of Milan. But
12 balls Root's face, 6 scoring shots. Yeah, took that Hamid didn't score in his last 29 balls.
Mm. Yeah.
And had got rather stuck.
He had got rather stuck. 182 for two.
Yeah, sorry, yeah, back foot, yeah. Middle and leg, front foot, leg, or you might go middle. So you then can spend a good minute.
Yeah. Oh, you could.
Scratching around.
Totally legit. Shammy into Root, who defends, covering up, plays it square of the wicket in the offside. There's no run.
I was going to say, sorry, after you take your guard as well, I like a walk away to square leg, then come back.
Oh, yeah.
Buy you another 15. Sorry, Andy.
So in terms of speeding the game up, why don't they just paint lines on the in the crease, on the lines of the stumps?
They do get worn away quite quickly.
Painting, yeah, still gives you an
as
idea.
As in all the way. Well, yeah, that's
a really
good point.
Just up to the crease.
Indelible ink.
That's a really good point. But then that would...
well, then that would take time.
Take away
from
our
game plan. Wasting out of it, wouldn't it? That'd be the point, isn't that? Shammy into Root, who defends the last ball of the session up to mid-on. And there's no run. He survives. England 182 for two. They've built a lead now of 104. They've lost both openers. Burns bowled by Shammy for 61. And then the beauty to get rid of Haseeb Ahmed, who only added 8 runs to his overnight total over the course of about an hour and a half, but he stayed there, was bowled by Jadeja for 68. Those are the two wickets to four. What have you spotted, Ebony?
There's a big hug. You saw Siraj going up to Bumrah to apologise. And it was a bit frosty, and then he just threw his arms around him, said, "It's all right, mate. I got you."
So all's well now.
So all is well.
26 runs, 26 overs, sorry, in that session. 62 runs, 2 wickets. Milan scored 27 of them. Root, 14, going into lunch. And England are building a very, very strong platform. It's not been scintillating cricket, but it has been exactly, I think, what England would have planned at the start of the day. I don't really know now whether that's India's or England's session. Within the context of the game, it's definitely England's session, because India needed to bounce back a bit more strongly. But India bowled well. They bowled with resolution. They were accurate. Some thoughts from Ebony on the morning session. And then I think it will be Jonathan Agnew.
Well, it's still tough toil for India for a little while, getting that breakthrough. First off, Burns from Shammy, and then later on, Jadeja just getting one to sneak through. And I think what India did well is they didn't offer a huge amount of runs. England were drying up as such, so didn't take the game away. However, England are really nicely poised. It's not often that Joe Root comes to the crease with runs on the board and opportunity to play in his style that suits him. And also then the depth of the likes of Butler and Moeen, etc., can capitalise later. So England still massively in the driving seat.